first paper, Webized 3D Experience by HTML5 Annotation in 3D Web. It's our first paper. Bong-Yung Yu will present. Sorry for misspelling your name. I'll make the presentation. Go ahead. Thank you.
Thanks, Billy. My name is Bong-Yung Yu. I know it's hard to pronounce, so no problem. The presentation is about HTML5 annotation on 3D web contents. We call it Webized 3D Experience as means of annotation. And the presentation is composed of these. I will try to not exceed 15 minutes.
Yeah, we'll try to keep it for 15 minutes, and if you have questions, we'll have 3 minutes extra time.
And the motivation is like this. I would like to thanks to everybody, including the Web3D community, because the 3D objects are now handled as HTML markup without plugins on web pages. It is really, really, really fabulous. We can just type the URL and play with 3D models without any rigorous resource like the installing plugin as we used to do long ago. However, although declarative 3D objects are physically integrated into web pages, still 3D objects involve the same separation issue of the HTML element from the perspective of 3D layout. So I would like to show some example. When it comes to the 3D experience, once people are ready to play with the 3D model, it means that there's no problem on the navigating and exploring 3D model on the web page, then I think the further step, the next step is something like the annotating, because we always would like to share our experience on the contents. It's exactly the same in the trend of web from the web 1.0 to web 2.0, as people call the web 1.0 as read-only model, but the web 2.0 is a read and write model. So this is a CAD model I just captured from the X3DOM example use case, and this is not that complicated assembly model, but usually people want to annotate some practical part of the model to share their expression or some needs of modification of the CAD model. Then it's not, it seems like it's perfectly working even though the 3D context of the CAD model is not shared with the annotation itself, because we can still follow the relationship between this annotation and the specific CAD part of assembly through the color highlight of the 3D model. But let's assume more complicated cases like this. This is also an example from the X3DOM use case. And as the CAD model and annotation goes more complicated, we usually like to align the 3D perspectiveness of annotation and the CAD model itself, because if we lose the relationship between the annotation and the CAD, it is really hard to catch which annotation is about the which target. So it's basic needs of annotation of a complicated 3D model, I think. But practically, actually, the this use case is not implemented the separation with the separation of annotation and the 3D object. Instead of that, the annotation is directly implemented inside of a 3D scene. So actually, the annotation is, I just checked that it is the render the PNG image and it is textured into the aligned plan of the 3D model. But that's what we want to do, actually. I would like to introduce some toy scenario of authoring 3D web with annotation. I would like to create a 3D scene with solar system. It is just a declarative 3D scene here. And I would like to annotate each planet with each external web resource from the anywhere, like YouTube or Vimeo, and as well as the, some social network services like Facebook, Twitter, blah, blah, blah. Then what we usually to do is just add a transparent layer on top of 3D scene and use widely used just a 2D page media and render the HTML resource on top of that. In this case, it is really hard to share the actually the perspectiveness between these two. And rather than that, what I want to do is like this. Still, I want to keep using external resource, any kind of web resource, HTML5, for annotating specific part of 3D contents, and at the same time, I want to keep sharing the perspectiveness of the target object and the annotated 3D contents. Then I just like to summarize some previous work. Jankowski classified these two kind of integration model of 3D web contents, and the left side is widely used case. We often just author web page and embed a 3D model, even if it is the declarative 3D, we usually create 2D canvas and render and projected 3D. The rendered frame is embedded on top of the 2D page media. And in contrast, if the 3D content is more dominant part of the web document, then we usually arrange a large part of web page with the 3D contents and add some additional layer like this. But as I showed you before in other example, it is hard to share the perspectiveness between these two. And there are some other previous work. If we more concerned about the just preciseness of annotation, rather than the usability of the HTML5 which contains from external resource, then we can just put like this, add a practical, a specific 3D shape as your annotation is directly inside of a 3D scene. It's just putting the red 3D cone to annotate 3D model. And in other case, if we more concerned about the use of external resource rather than the preciseness, then there has been lots of the previous work to use the web resource as an image texture or the movie texture. So they stream down the dynamic rendered web page resource and just use it as a movie texture or image texture. But one of the disadvantages in this category is like this. We can share the visual, the rendered resource, but it is not sharing the user interaction model itself of the HTML5 functionally. So here I'd like to introduce our approach. We call the WebIgen 3D experience as means of annotating 3D content with HTML5 resource. And our method is a web annotation to declare the relationship between 3D target object and HTML annotation element and still share the 3D layout context on the web. And we are now here, we commonly use the declarative 3D technique. And then on top of that, what we want to do is share 3D context of 3D scene and HTML annotation using CSS 3D. So if I classify the formal approach, then usually, because the original intention of web browser is rendering media into 2D page media. For a long time, the web page was 2D, so that's the intention. So The form of HTML element is rendered in 2D page media, and of course 3D contents are also rendered and projected into 2D planar surface, and then it is rendered into 2D page media. So it is hard to share the perspectiveness and 3D context between these two. So we proposed some other simple idea that how we can put these two together into a single 3D world and share the context of 3D scene. And then we thought that if it is possible, then the user can add or comment or annotate any kind of HTML resource directly into the 3D model, and then still they can share the context in 3D. And once a user transform the target object, and then we can still keep the relationship between location and target visually. So in order to make it possible, we accommodated a simple semantic approach using schema from schema.org, which is one of widely used schema developed by the web portal industry like Google and Yahoo. And it is a very simple schema, just we use five properties because the relationship between the target object and location is just a simple information for target URL and the annotation URL, and the remaining three properties are the relative spatial information. So if I show you the very simple example of the declarative way of annotating 3D model, 3D web content, then as you expected, 3D target object is declared as a declarative 3D grid. And then the upper part is 3D target, and the lower part is about the annotation. So we annotate with the schema defined in schema.org, and here is the simple mechanism to recognize the relationship between target and the annotation using hashtag and def mechanism in X3D. And of course, it is the annotation using HTML. So any kind of resource in HTML5, even external HTML5 resource using iframe, is also possible. So I will show some simple prototype implementation. It's still early stage of implementation. So we just implemented JavaScript functions on top of 3.js, and we had to split the X3D renderer with the CSS 3D renderer in order to render target and the annotation and keep the separation of concern. And then the rendered image scenes are integrated into scene graph integrator. So left image is rendered scene of the target object, and right scene is the rendered image of annotation, the web HTML5 annotation, and it is beautifully merged into a single scene. And because of the internet status in this venue, I just prepare the movie. Oops. Okay. I hope the sound is available, but I'm not so sure. So because it is not just sharing the visual part of HTML resource, it is direct integration of 3D model and the annotation. So not only I can hear vaguely the sound from the machine, but I don't know how we can manipulate the volume. So yeah. So the YouTube content is rendered inside of annotation, and still the user can use any interaction model implemented in the web service. So the user, the developer, doesn't need to add any other resource to enable something like a video, audio, or interaction model of the video as well. But this has still lots of limitations because we just implemented this on top of Suite.js. I will mention in the discussion slide. So this is another toy example. And so if I summarize our the proposed approach, then we just propose a method for WebRTC 3D experience as means of annotation. And because it is not just sharing 3D context, but also it is integration of the external 3D web resource with 3D content. So any kind of interaction model implemented in HTML5 is still available without any redundant effort. And also, we can keep render 3D object with annotation, but the one specific limitation of this is our prototype implementation is very early stage, so it is limited to sharing only context of 3D layout and context of monotheic contents, and we couldn't tackle the sharing the lower level the process pipeline such as depth buffer. So we still have the occlusion issue when we dynamically change the viewpoint. And we think this is the fabulous advantage. We can use any kind of resource in the annotation. So we found big needs in the CAD industry, like the additive manufacturing and makers community. They want to share their 3D model in the social network, and they usually like to share their experience as well. Experience means annotation about the CAD model. So we would like to extend our implementation into the 3D CAD cloud-based systems.
Thank you very much.
Hi there, thanks very much, very interesting talk. I have a couple questions. The first question is, one of the issues it seems with using the dual context for your for 3D, so using Web 3D for the actual 3D scene and then CSS 3D for the annotations, is that you're losing the depth information because you're essentially painting the CSS 3D as a layer on top of the 3D rendering. And a few times in the video I got confused. I thought, is it not working very well? Obviously, they agree as well. And I realized that it wasn't that it was the actual transformations were working perfectly, it was just that the annotation was drawn on top, and so you lost the depth information.
Yeah.
So I'm wondering what your thoughts about that. And the second thing is, have you thought about building in a real-time component to allow sharing of the annotations between multiple users of the same session?
For the second question, I haven't thought about that yet, because we are still early stage of prototype implementation. And for the first question, I already mentioned the disadvantage of this early stage of implementation, because we just implemented on top of 3.js pipeline and CSS 3D implemented on 3.js, so we couldn't tackle the sharing the depth buffer between these two pipelines. But we already understood that the way to tackle the issue, we can just tackle the graphics pipeline of browser itself, then we can share the depth buffer. And we expected that we will tackle that issue, but this effort started a few months ago. So
you just export the depth buffer to a texture and use that in your second rendering, or something similar. Okay, thanks.
Thank you. Any other questions? And we are going to move on to our next presenter. And that is with urban data visualization in a web browser.
Hello, I'm Jamie Ayar, and I'm going to present you the work of the Lewis Lab on a framework to visualize urban data in a web browser. So web technologies are coming to the point where the complex 3D applications are possible on the web. WebGL and JavaScript. WebGL is natively supported on most modern web browsers, which allows such applications to work without plugins. A popular use of this kind of technologies is the sharing of virtual city models. Virtual city models have a variety of use, such as collaborative urban management, simulation, or emergencies training, for example. These use cases need rich models to function, even on the client. Both semantic and geometric information is needed. I would also like to point out the importance of standards, since all our data is not necessarily stored on the same server. So, therefore, we face a number of challenges. Virtual cities are huge data models that can take up to several hundreds of gigabytes of data. So we have to manage all this data while keeping a fluid visualization. We have to aggregate data from multiple data stores, as I stated earlier. And it can be a nice thing to be able to have multiple representation of the data depending on the user's need. For example, on the left you can see a representation of a city containing only the remarkable buildings and the bike stations for example, the tourism map. And on the right, there is another use case for urban planners, where you have all the buildings in the city represented in a mockup. So, we present our framework with five major contributions. We have efficient visualization. We have a solution that is based around standards that allow us to have access to multiple sources of open data. We can access semantic information even from the client. We introduce the prioritization for the loading of data to improve user experience, and prioritization that can depend on the user profile. And finally, we use progressive textures. So, my presentation will be structured as follows. I will start by positioning our work in the state of the art. Then I will explain how the framework works. And after a quick demonstration, I will show the result of our implementation, and I will conclude. So let's start with what it works. So on the field of 3D rendering on the web, 3D rendering on the web has basically the same approach as 2D rendering, which is the declarative approach, which integrates the data to be rendered directly into the DOM, and after that, the browser renders the scene directly with a fixed pipeline. The other approach is the imperative one, which uses JavaScript and the WebGL to render the scene. Since it's more flexible, we chose this approach for our solution, since we are in an early stage with many experimentation. So the visualization of 3D GIS data happens at a variety of scales, from global applications to the visualization of the interior of the buildings. Our solution belongs in the middle, to the class of city viewers, where we can view buildings up close, but also explore whole cities and their surroundings. I will now explain how our viewer works. So, I will start by presenting the general architecture of the viewer. Then I will explain the process by which our data is prepared to allow efficient visualization. And I will talk about the core of our application, the client architecture. After that, I will speak about the scheduler and how it allows us to prioritize data loading. And finally, I will speak about additional data that we can integrate in our framework. So, the user interacts with the client by moving the camera, his camera within the browser. Depending on the position of the camera, the client will send a request to the server using the 3D portrayal pending protocol. The requested data will be sent back to the client. This data is processed using JavaScript, and the scene data is rendered using WebGL with the 3.js library. So, CTGML is an OGC standard for the exchange and the modeling of urban data. While it is very extensive, it is not adapted to a client-server application, since it uses XML formatting that is not easy parsable with JavaScript, and because it weighs often several hundred of gigabytes. Because of that, we convert the CTGML into a JSON format. It is both more compact and easy to parse in JavaScript. And we also convert the textures from their original JPEG or PNG format to DDS. So DDS files have the advantage of being readable directly by the GPU without being decompressed. So this avoids VRAM saturation and allows us to use progressive textures with MIPMAP. So to convert the CTGML into JSON, we use the Lyrisys software that reads and process CTGML, that's called Prediuse. It will soon be released as open source, and this is the subject of other publications. In our framework, Prediuse is used to cut the CTGML into different tiles and to convert each of the CTGML tiles into JSON files that contain each a single layer and load level. All these JSON files are put into a file tree, so they can be easily accessed, knowing only the coordinates of the tile, layer type, and the load level. So, for the rest of the presentation, when I will speak about tiles, I will refer to the tile with a specific layer and load level. So, next, let's speak about the client. So, the client is composed of three main modules: the time manager, the texture manager, and the scheduler. The role of the scheduler is to queue tasks coming from the time manager and the texture manager, and to execute them at the appropriate moment. So, depending on the camera position, the time manager chooses which tiles have to be rendered, and a task to load the geometry of the tile is added to the scheduler. When the scheduler decides that it's time to execute these tasks, it triggers a geometry request that will go to the server, and the server will send back the JSON files containing the geometry and eventually the semantic information contained in the file. latent mesh will be added to the semi, and if need be, a texture manager will be created to texture the mesh. So the texture manager will start by creating the default material and add a task to the scheduler to download the texture. When the order is triggered, HTTP request is sent to the server to fetch the BDS texture that is then added to the material. So, now more detail on the scheduler. So, to choose which task to execute first, we add priority to each task. Now, in our implementation, we have three priority types. Top priority, that is reserved only for data loading operations. High priority and large priority, that depend on the strategy that is currently in use. So, the strategy decides to assign high or low priority depending on a number of factors. Such as the nature of the task, the type of layer, the distance to the from the camera to the tile, etc. So, in this image, you can see a simple example of a strategy that we implemented that loads in a high priority the close digital elevation model and the building of the common tile, and loads as low priority the distance digital elevation model and close buildings. So our framework can also manage additional data. We use open layers to read web feature service standardized streams and then process the data of open layers to convert them into 3D geometries that insert into the markup. We all, 3GS also allows us to display point clouds. This data is treated the same way as other layers in the tile manager. So let's see the result of our implementation and start with a short demonstration of the framework. As you can see, we have a texture free model for the city. There we load different texture resolution. We can choose which layer to hide or to show. Then we have only remarkable buildings of Lyon that are displayed. And here we add data from WFS streams, like live stations or the location of the trees. We have also point clouds rendering. So I'll quickly finish by showing results. So these are the time for the single tile, the parsing time, download time, processing time for a single tile. You can see that we have low parsing time due to the use of JSON, and we can also see that the high disparity in loading time justifies the use of data loading prioritization. Conclusion: we introduced a framework that allows efficient visualization of data from different sources thanks to the use of standards. We use BDS textures that are easily readable by the GPU, and mismaps for protected texturing, and we introduce data loading parameterization. In future works, we would like to investigate other texture formats that are not subject to patterns like BDS. We'll also like to add multi-threading through web worker integration, so we can remove the slight stuttering we have when new data is loaded. And finally, we would like to enable individual building page king, since actually we're forced to merge different geometries together because of GPU limitation. So all this work will be done with the French company Oslandia, who is funding the team that I just started. And so the next version will be done in collaboration with this company. Thanks for your attention.
Thank you very much. We have time for one question. So I guess it's my time for questions. I have one question. The sources of data, where do you get the sources of the data? Is it easy to obtain them, or what exactly for the city model?
The city GML file is open, since it's the Lyon city that is giving them for the community.
Well, is it for a specific area, or just that?
It's all the city. And all what is called the Grand Lyon, with Lyon and the surrounding city.
And the additional data you have there, LiDAR
yes.
And all the other information, is it freely available?
It's the same, available.
But I'm assuming it's available for a specific region. It's not available for, let's say, a city in Romania, let's say.
No, it's just for the city.
Okay, so it has been done by somebody before. And made available public. Well, thank you very much. All right, so let's see. We have the third paper, which is applicability of watermarking for intellectual property rights protection in 3D printing scenarios, or in a 3D printing scenario. This is our third full paper.
Okay, thank you very much. So this paper has been prepared by myself, Mirela Montagnola here, and Patrice Rondao-Alpache. Patrice is with Alcatel-Lucent in Antwerp, in Belgium, and Mirela is working with Deutsche Telekom in Darmstadt. So our idea was to use watermarking in a 3D scenario, and to see where it can be useful. Just a small recall, watermarking is the process by which you can hide information into a signal. It's very much used in audio and image signal, and it's used a lot in digital cinema for copyright protection. I will give a few words on it. But it can be also used for authentication if you have a certificate or something like that, a paper certificate. Watermark is used on banknotes. It can be used also for content enrichment, for data hiding. It's used for by the mafia to hide some information in a usual photograph. You send a picture of your vacation, and there is a secret message hidden in your vacation picture. It's a way to hide information. And of course, the requirements are depending on the application. If you need copyright protection, the requirement will be robustness, security. If it is just hiding information, imperceptibility and capacity are enough. So why to do watermarking in an IPR scenario? It's very well understood in the field of digital cinema. In the field of digital cinema, you are producing a digital movie, you are compressing it, and this is the studio distributor. You are sending the digital movie in the theater, and then everything is going well. everything is going well, you can protect by ciphering the data, everything is going well until the digital the bits are transformed into light. When you go from the digital world to the analog world, there is a hole here, because you are not anymore protected. There could be a digital video camera in the theater, and you can recapture the movie, and that's the reason why you have on peer-to-peer network a blockbuster one or two days after they are in the theater, because they have people with digital camera in the theater. And so nowadays, watermark is used to put the name of the theater and the date of projection so that you can blacklist the guys who leave a digital camera inside the theater. So when we go for the 3D world, in fact, we will have many holes, because the digital information is conveyed thanks to X3D and thanks to Web3D, thanks to the work that you are doing. But after a while, there will be analog holes, because those 3D models will go to 3D printer. And when you have a 3D model, when it's 3D printed, you can rescan it, and you can redigitize it, and you can redistribute it. And so the big growing market, the market will be increased by 500% in 5 years from now. The big market of 3D printer is a big hole for the 3D content. So when you see the application domain, I will not elaborate on that. We are discussing a little bit with Materialize, which is a Belgian company working on it. You have many important applications with digital assets with a lot of value. For example, if you think to art and design, this is a dress, printed, 3D printed dress with a design which is very valuable, because it's a very valuable artist, a high-valued artist which designed it. Of course, in the field of automotive, in the field of medicine, you have a lot of very high-value devices. Some devices need certificated devices. If you change a piece in your car, you would like to know that the piece is well certified by the original company. If you have a big German car, you want to have a high quality piece in your German car. Okay, so we can see the 3D watermarking in several scenarios. So you have the designer, you have the 3D product, and you have the copies which are here, and you can have a copy in the distribution system. So that this is the first kind of things that you would like to protect, is to avoid counterfeiting by the people thinking the 3D product. Other things which are, and when you have printed a device, you can rescan it. For example, you have a big 3D model, you sell it to someone, and you say you are allowed to print 10 times this model. When the guy is producing 10,000 times the model, you would like to know it. And so to have a respect of the contract is something important. Another use of watermarking is the traceability and authentication. You produce a 3D object, and you would like the people to reproduce the object with a certain range of security. You would like to have a fidelity criterion for your reproduction. So in that case, to put secret mark, verify if the secret mark is still in the object is of big interest, because you can prove by the watermark that the quality of the reproduction of the 3D model is ensured. So traceability and authentication are other use of 3D printing. And of course, this is also the case here, you can put some testing lab to verify that the whole chain, 3D modeling, distributing, and printing is properly correct. Another way to use 3D watermarking, and this is the last part of my introduction, is to put side information that is cross-standard, that is readable across standards. If you have a 3D object and you want to have some annotation, for example, the way you would print it, you want to have origin, and you want to have additional information, it can be useful to not extend a standard, but to put this information as a side information in a watermark on the 3D object. So that could be also of interest to for some particular applications. So this is the introduction. So to recall, 3D watermark hides a secret. As a secret in the 3D object. And so we will see the way we will introduce the object. You see the bunny on the left side and the bunny on the right side. Of course, we have amplified too much the watermark. You see that the 3D object is not the same as the original object because it contains a certain amount of information that is repeated many times with error correcting codes so that we can retrieve a certain amount of bits that are inserted in the object. And if you accept a certain amount of distortion, you have a higher resistance. If you want to have a very high fidelity of your object, of course, the resistance against attacks is lower. So there is a gain between the resistance and the imperceptibility of the watermark inside your 3D object. So the most naive approach to do watermark is to work on meshes and to do flippings of triangle into a mesh. And you can say, for each triangle, I will write a 1 if the summit of the triangle is on the right side, and I will write a 0 if the summit of the triangle is on the left side. And so you can flip the summit to write a 1 or a 0. And so you can put a big amount of money on triangles by simply flipping the summit of triangles. Some of the triangle cannot be flipped, and there are some mathematical constraints, but you can trace a path in your 3D shape and put a lot of watermark bits inside a shape. And the biggest the shape, of course, the biggest the load you can put in your 3D object. So, of course, you can ensure imperceptibility, you can ensure secrecy by choosing a secret path on your shape, but of course, it's very fragile because it's very easy to change and to remesh your 3D object, and of course, all the bits are disappearing when you are remeshing your 3D shape. So, it can be not used for copyright protection, but it can be used to hide a big amount of information, okay? So to go further, we need to go further, and one extra information I would like to discuss with you is to know whether the watermark is blind or non-blind. A non-blind watermark means that you have the original 3D shape, and you have the watermark shape, and you can, by code registration, retrieve the watermark by using the original shape. This is used for digital cinema. In digital cinema, when you have a blockbuster, you have a copy of the blockbuster, you have the blockbuster, so you can use a non-blind detection. But the most interesting thing is to do blind detection. You don't need the original object, and you are still able to retrieve the watermark, okay? So to do a blind detection and robust detection, you need some specific thing. So, what about the attacks? The different attacks that you can face when you do a watermark is additive noise, smoothing, which is very important in 3D printing, because when you do 3D printing, there is a smoothing process after the printing. Cropping, you in some cases you need to be able to be resistant against cropping. Decimation, of course, if you do remeshing with less detail, you have to be, subdivision is also the things that we have to face. So how do we do robust blind watermarking? We do robust blind watermarking by modifying locally the surfaces, and we use the concept of spectral decomposition of the surface, and we do this local modification on around key points. In our algorithm, we have used two kinds of key points, which are the umbilical points or the prongs. Umbilical points are based on curvature analysis. Prongs are used on the global shape of the information. So what about spectral analysis and spectral modification of a shape? So if you see a mesh is composed of a geometry, you know that, You have all the x, y, z coordinates of each point, and you have the connectivity, all the points which are numbered here are connected together to become a triangle. You can give a number to the triangle also. Okay? So what is spectral watermarking? The spectral watermarking is based on the spectral decomposition of 3D mesh, and the spectral decomposition is obtained by the Laplacian operator of the connectivity matrix. If you do the Laplacian, the Eigen vector decomposition of the connectivity matrix, you get a spectral decomposition of the picture. So for example, if you have this picture, the spectral components are those ones, and to recompose the full detailed picture, you have to add those pictures here. Here there are some eigenvectors of 3D shapes. You see here a different resolution, and you can do a watermark by quantizing a spectral component and forcing it to be below or above a certain threshold. This is known as quantization index modulation. By quantizing the spectral composition, it's doable to put a lot of information into a shape, and this embedding of the information is not depending on the meshing, it's just depending on the physical property of the object. So you are simply modifying, introducing some minor modification on the surface that are analyzed and that can be retrieved by a simple frequential analysis of the surface. So for example, you see here the bunny with a watermarking force. If you this is the close to the original, but if you put too much force, it's like a bunny who is doing bodybuilding with a lot of extra muscle amplification of surfaces. So I will not elaborate too much, but it's possible to get a lot of resistance against that. And then the next point, and I will not elaborate because I don't have so much time, is the umbilical points. The umbilical points are points where the curvature is modifying. For example, you see here the curvature, if you do a multi-resolution analysis, you can get umbilical points as points where the curvature is changing in the three-dimensional domain. And so when you have umbilical points, it's possible to put patches and modify the frequency to put information inside the information. And an alternative to do it is to analyze prompts and to do the same with prompts. I will jump above it because I would like just to say you a first the more sentences. So we are able to resist with current algorithm to a lot of attacks if the signal is redundant enough, and that opens that path the way to have watermarking, which allows to trace the usage of 3D printers and to have a continuity between the virtual world and the physical world. You are producing a 3D object, you put the watermark, and the watermark will remain after 3D printing. After rescanning, you are able to retrieve the watermark. And so the current research is to observe what is possible to do and to have specific things, resistance to additive manufacturing, to smoothening, and there are a lot of interesting questions to develop to improve the algorithm to be resistant against all that. And one current research also is to, and I will stop there, is to try to find efficient watermarking algorithms which allow to retrieve the watermark by a few 2D views from the 3D models. And it's doable. Mm-hmm. There are already some interesting publications on which people are working, and we have people in our team working also on specific algorithms which allow to be retrieved not by a full 3D scanning, but by some few views of the 3D objects. And so the ongoing and future work is to continue to test the robustness of the frequential embedding of the watermark, the robustness of the key points, because we are losing sometimes some key points. Umbilical points are quite fragile, prongs are more resistant, and of course the reason why I'm listening a lot to you nowadays is to be compliant with standards, with compression standards, and with 3D formats to see what all we can do the best usage of that kind of technology. Thank you very much for your
talk.
A very interesting presentation, and I'm sure that Nicolas may think about some potential additions to the X3 DORM, specifically DORM for the military applications, maybe. I know it's kind of a conflict in a sense that, you know, we try to share, but you're right, I mean, some industrial cases maybe copyright protection for the 3D
models. It's not only about copyright protection. As I said, some of the watermarks are useful because you need to convey some information that you want to lose when you have a format conversion. You want to have some essential information embedded in the shape that remains in the shape. And it's not only about IPR. And some also of the watermark is the contrary information, because in IPR you want the watermark to remain whatever happens. Yeah. But in some other case, you want to have a shape, you put the watermark, and the role of the watermark is to certify that the 3D object is still in the range that you define. And so if the printer is of low quality, the watermark is disappearing, and so you cannot retrieve the authentication watermark, and so you can say the 3D printer did a bad job. So the usage can be very broad. It's not only about
Not only cyber.
I know the spirit here is open source, and I'm also in this spirit. A key point is to have unpatented 3D watermarks, and all watermarks we didn't took patents. The watermark. Maybe this is a key problem.
Okay. Thank you very much. Any questions? All right, so let's see.
Indeed, a great talk. Did I get the point right that you do slightly modify the geometry in order to keep the watermark in? Not the last application said if it's too low a quality, then you just, for example, warranty would become void.
Yeah, we introduce indeed some...
Which is a very clever idea, but the other one is sort of speaking of the text, and then sort of the question is what kind of manipulations you're resistant against. And it seems that sort of in order to keep the watermark even through the process of printing and scanning, you might need to change the geometry, which is not always possible if you have, think of a CAD model where you have to have perfect rotational symmetry and then you start sort of playing. Yeah. Suddenly sort of that element might not be rotational symmetrical and then can't be
used. For resistant watermark, it's only valuable for design objects where you don't have a CAD model. If you have a very flat CAD model, the modifying the frequencies is quite problematic. It has to be slight enough. I fully agree that.
But I just want to make sure I understand the point. It's still very usable help.
For CAD model, we already tried it, and it's a little bit dangerous because then you don't have any more a flat surface, but at the corner you have some slight modification that could be very annoying for a CAD,
cool.
A mechanical piece, could be problematic.
I got the same question.
Thank you.
All right. Thank you very much. Two words.
Thank you.
One shot. Excellent.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
All right. Our next speaker. We'll present a web-based data visualization of an MMO virtual regatta using a virtual globe.
Okay, so hi everyone, me again. This time I have the pleasure of presenting the work of my colleague, Gerard Urach, who very sadly is in a meeting in Rotterdam this weekend, today. We're in Crete. I'll say more about that. We're presenting his work, is based on visualization of big data, so tying in with what I was talking about earlier and what several people have been talking about. And specifically from the Barcelona World Race. Now, the Barcelona World Race, if you haven't heard of it, is a regatta, it's a sailing race, where crews of two people sail around the world. They leave Barcelona and they go around the world without stopping for three or four months, and they compete to do so, it's a race. And it's quite a challenge because obviously they've got to live together for two people for 3 months on a boat and sail non-stop around the world from Barcelona to Barcelona via New Zealand, basically. And it's happened 3 times now. The third edition was this winter. And 4 years ago, in the previous edition, our university was approached by the organizers to make a game for the Barcelona World Race. And the idea was this game would be an MMO, a massive multiplayer online game, whereby you could sail your virtual boat and compete against the real boats and all the other virtual sailors in real time with the same weather conditions. And that was quite good fun. Basically, we had tens of thousands of people playing and sailing their virtual boats, competing in real time against the real sailors and the real regatta. It wasn't obviously a permanent game. You logged in every 3 or 4 hours to check your boat's course or whatever and check the local latest weather forecast. And we did a 3D component as well, the last one in WebGL, which I might show later on in the demo tomorrow or whatever. And it was quite good, but that's not what I'm here to talk about, essentially. What I'm here to talk about is the data that's come out of that game. And it's a really amazing source of data because you have the parts of several tens of thousands of virtual boats who have traversed the world, gone around the world, over the course of 3 months, right? And it's a very interesting data source because you get to play with it and visualize it, and the natural thing is to visualize it on a globe. And that's what Gerard set out to do, and that's kind of what I'm going to describe the challenges, the technical challenges he faced in visualizing that in a WebGL context. We actually have data sources from the previous edition of 50,000 boats, but the latest edition was capped at 17,000 boats. So we only have 17,000 boats. And between the data points of all the data stored, so every time the boat changed direction or changed sail or whatever it was, or changed speed, between your 17,000 boats going all the way around the world for 3 months, you've got 20 million points to render. That's the challenge, basically. We'll render that in a vaguely sensible idea way on the web. And unless there are some approximations of doing particle rendering with tens of millions of points on WebGL, they're all done by the GPU, none of them were particularly adequate for this thing. We need to have some CPU interaction. And so we basically couldn't render our 20 million points on a virtual globe with a normal computer. So that was the problem. That's where Gerard was starting, approaching the tackle. How am I going to visualize as many boats as possible with some sort of real-time interactivity? So as I said, we used the virtual globe. We had an interesting talk going on about the difference between different coordinates and between Cartesian and globe coordinates and so on and so forth. Visualizing it on a globe is a more natural way of seeing things, I think, rather than seeing on a 2D map. We like the idea of seeing a virtual globe. It appeals to us if you're seeing data that's linked to the world. And also, on a more practical level, if you're actually drawing an R2D map, it's going to distort distances, especially in the polar regions. It's going to make small distances look very large, and so the globe is a very neat approach for that. That's why we went for the globe approach. And the first challenge is basically to draw the lines. As I said, drawing 17,000 lines with this number of data points per line was just too much. So the way we decided to do it was basically cut the lines and draw a certain subset of the lines. And so instead of drawing the entire line for the entire path, the entire 3 months, we would just draw the time slot moved forward through the 3 months, we would draw just a subset, the tip of the line, if you like, to show where the boat was going and a slight trail from where. From the last day's worth of travel. But the problem with doing that, if you're just drawing the very tip of where the boat was going, is that you're losing the interesting information about where the boat has gone, right? So you're losing that density map of where all the boats have gone over the course of the 3 months, right? And so that cutting the line, if you like, solves one problem, but it removes one of the advantages of visualization. And so, the approach to recuperate that information lost is to, in parallel, draw a density map progressively to a texture so that that image, that the information about the lines where the boats have gone, is actually stored as pixels on a texture, which of course is rendered very quickly because it's rendered with just the geometry of the globe and the pixels are painted on top of it, right? So it's a combining the just rendering the tip of the lines and rendering the texture. So let's talk, and that's the result of how the texture looks, and I'll show a video later on so you can see it in more detail, right? So let's just talk briefly about how it's implemented. Basically, to draw the tip of the line of each boat, basically we had to get a mesh and update it constantly. I think Gerard used some web workers to make sure it ran fairly well. And that was a little bit of a challenge because the data is not regularly sampled. For reasons of economy of space, when we were recording the data of the boat as they traversed the world, we didn't record at regular time intervals, because if the boat is going in a straight line for 10 kilometers, there's no need to record every 10 minutes the position of that boat. We can just record when they turned onto that path and when they turned off that path. So we had to have some sort of like interpolation of the raw data to make sure that the lines that are being drawn in the rendering, which did have to have a regular sample and a regular size, were interpolated correctly according to the data. And that requires a bit of processing. And we had two methods of doing that. Once, I think it was the method Gerard used at the end, he liked the most, was with the CPU, with web workers. Basically just a way of interpolating through time for the next sample. Not particularly complicated, but it needed to be done. The second implementation was the density map, and that was, again, an interesting idea of just basically progressively taking a texture and rendering into a texture and not clearing the color buffer every frame, and just carry on rendering. Every time you draw the line, the tip of the line of the boat, you just draw the line onto that texture as well, and it gradually builds up the nice density map that you saw earlier on, and we'll see again. And then that is just basically a texture, which every frame is applied to the virtual globe, and the result is you get this nice density where the boats have gone without having to draw the lines every time. The resolution of the texture map is obviously important. A higher resolution gets you a greater level of information about where the boats have gone, but a lower resolution obviously is faster, and so I'll present some numbers about that later on in the thingy. Here's a few images that are just to give you a little heads up before we see the video. And here is the video, so let's assume this works. Ah, it's gone back. And play. So, Yes. Skip forward. So this is visualizing all the lines. I think this is 1,000 lines or something. This is with no optimization at all. You can see it's crawling a little bit. And this basically, we couldn't do this with 17,000 lines. It was impossible to do. So we had to skip forward. But because more than 10,000 boats, the application would completely crash. So let me just skip forward a little bit. So this is the half of the approximation, just rendering the tip of each boat. I love the fact that there are some guys, they're supposed to go down to Brazil right here. I love the fact some guys are bugging off to Iceland or something like that. I don't know where they're going. They think it's fun to go up there. And there's some guy comes to Crete by this thing as well.
Is that the drunk or sailor problem?
Yeah. So as you can see, it's a nice visualization, but it doesn't have the detail of where the boats have gone. You don't have a density map. This isn't a representation of the evolution of the density map on its own, so without combining the lines. It's just that they can density map every frame, and you see it's building up. You don't get the tips of where the boats are, but you do get the paths of where they've gone. One aspect of future work is to maybe do some non-linearity here. At the moment, that density map is very linear, so you can see it's saturating in the areas where lots of boats are going. It'd be nice to have a little bit more non-linearity there to be able to see things. And here's the final results with 17,000 boats, updating the texture as well, and you can see it's a very nice visualization whereby you can see the actual tips of the boat, tips of the lines moving on, but we've got the density information in the background as well. I'm going to skip through on a little bit so you can just see some, and you can see they're going down to Brazil, the poor blighters coming out of Africa and are going to go a bit slow. And there's one interesting point I thought you might like to see here. There's a gate here. They have to. All the boats have to come above a certain point of the map. It's here. Oops, the light's moving. It's here. Ah! It's
there. You get the picture. So the boats all have to sort of swing in to make sure they get through the gates, otherwise they get disqualified from the race. There was a few other visualization flourishes that Gerard added because he was flexing his WebGL muscles, so he decided to add some funny things like... oops, that's gone. Let's see if we can skip forward to this. He decided to add day-night and sun position and things like that just to make it look interesting and some lens flare that he liked writing the shader for, etc., etc. And more interesting, perhaps, was the wind forecast data that he put on top of that as well, which is kind of cool. And that's what he's working on right now, is that when you zoom in, you progressively load in different levels of detail of the wind, so you can actually see where the boats have gone based on where the wind was at the time. We have that data stored as well. So it's all lots of interesting possibilities for visualization, for analysis of the regatta, analysis of how things worked. Just some very quick results on, just to put some numbers. As I said, doing all 17,000 boats could be done at once. This is just some stats with 5,000 boats. We had 6 million inverts and 14 FPS, which didn't really work. So above that didn't really work. 8,000 broke. There you go. You can change the number of vertices per line, which is quite a nice idea. So if you have a more powerful machine, you can add the number of vertices. What's interesting here is the difference between the frame rate of just the pure drawing of the GPU and the frame rate of updating the vertices. So if you put 30 vertices per part, so you draw along the line, the frame rate for actual drawing is still quite good, but the actual frame rate for updating the line is quite slow. So there's this kind of like parallel update versus draw issue you have. And then finally the texture size is just a simple number, unsurprisingly showing that with higher texture you get lower FPS, which is no real surprise. So basically, the conclusions are that you can adapt hardware to the higher frame rate, and I don't really like these conclusions, I don't think they make sense at all. But the point is, the conclusions are that it's quite fun to make it visualize game data by the web in this scenario. I think it makes a really interesting visualization that is kind of cool and very useful for people who are either playing the game or people who want to play the game in the future, or even real sailors who are looking at the real strategy for different places and how where they would go. And I guess the future work really is looking at way of progressively loading into the data. Right now, this doesn't do any sort of progressive loading from the server. It just assumes, just waits for you to download this entire chunk of data from the server and render it. And so it naturally, I think, lends itself to progressive download because obviously you're viewing through time. So I think that's the future work based on that. And that's all I have to say.
Questions?
Thank you very much. This density map visualization looks nice, but it loses quite a lot of information.
Yeah.
I was wondering if it would be possible to just render the position of balls on the texture and texture map on the model.
That's what exactly what it has done. So.
Yeah, but without doing the density map, but the exact position, so we see the other balls where they are going in different directions. Why do you use this density map?
So this density map is built over time through doing exactly that, of rendering the position of the boats on the texture. Exactly what it's done. So every frame, as well as rendering the line of the boat, we also render into the texture as well, the position of the boat. So that the density map is built up over time.
Okay, understand. So but why did you use the density map instead of the positions of the balls, as like in the previous example?
So we combine the two because density map doesn't a density map doesn't really give you that sort of visual impact of the movement of the boat. It's sort of I think you could do it. You could combine, I see what you're trying to say. Why bother doing the rendering in the first place? I don't know. I think the way it's done right now is that you get the impact of rendering on the globe with the line, and the density map is built up in the background. And I guess also I think the idea Gerard was having is the density map shouldn't really be a rendering, it should be more of an information map. But I think you're right here, you're losing a lot of information. I think if you applied some sort of non-linearity here, you'd get a much more valuable information. I'm sure there are more boats going through the middle here, along this main route here, than there are going to the side, but right now they're all white. So you lose that information. But yes, sorry, yes, I take your point. Yes.
So it seems like the density map is giving you more like a macro level.
Yeah. Yes,
view,
absolutely.
And then you can individually see each boat.
Yes, absolutely.
Like the other
yeah.
one. So it's an interesting problem if you could apply to whale migration or something like that would be interesting.
Well, I was trying to
the sensor.
Something earlier on talking about bird migration, they have sensors
bird
for birds,
migration,
which is
right.
interesting. I think there's a device or something earlier on. So, yeah, so very interesting. Yeah, good.
Thank you very much.
Great, thanks.
All right, so our last presenter is it's going to present the integration of urban spatial data with energy simulation to produce an X3D city model. And it's basically a use case scenario, and it's a really interesting presentation from what I remember, trying to evaluate the potential for photovoltaic cells on the rooftops of specific buildings.
Okay. Good afternoon. My name is Athanasios also, and I'm here to share with you an integration of urban spatial data with energy simulation demand, energy simulation output to produce activity city models. So this is the agenda. First I will describe the scope and next area of interest, the input data description, the tools we used, and the methodology analysis, and then I will summarize my presentation. So this is the scope. We have CDGML city models in LOD2 and LOD1, LAS terrain and orthophotos, and we want to generate X3D city models. The area of interest is Landkreis Ludwigsburg, which is a district in the southwest of Germany, in the state of Baden-Württemberg. And we have an area of 700 square kilometers and a population of 500,000 civilians. So the input data, we have 67 city models. They are encoded in CGML, LOD2 plus LOD1. The size on disk is 2.4 gigabytes, uncompressed. We have also more than 1,500 terentiles with 1 meter resolution. The size on disk is 43.5 gigabytes and the same number of orthophotos with 25 meter resolution. The size is 77.4 gigabytes. Additionally, we have photovoltaic potential and heat demand per building. And these results came out from SimStat simulation platform. So, summing up, we have 120 gigabytes of data, which is a quite large data set. So, I will describe the tools we used. Picture manipulation engine, we call it also Alchemy. It's a product developed by Safe Software, and it's another environment. So, we have the input elements, predefined transformers, and custom transformers, and we have also output elements. So the authoring environment, it is called also FME Workbench, offers more than 400 transformers and dozens of readers and writers. So we could use this approach, which is just direct conversion, but this type of approach is problematic because we get one index space for engineering. And this results in low frame rates in the player. For the simulation, we use the SimStat simulation platform. It's a project developed in Java from 2013, and it's, the development is ongoing. So this is our code. We want to achieve this integration using FME. And this is the methodology we came with. And I'm going to explain part by part. So for the terrain generation, So for today we use these two workbenches. So the first step was to generate an outline, which is a shape file. So we have the types of the terrains and additionally the location in the file system of each type. And because we have the same name scheme for the orthophotos, we have also the orthophotos. So this is how we query the terrain tiles and orthophotos. We calculate the city bounds of a city model, and then we intersect spatially with the terrain tiles. So we get the file names we need to process and the orthophotos. After we query the files, then we start a cleaning process for the terrain, and then there is something for the image. And we use YTIP, the XML templater, which is a predefined transformer, and we can generate XML. It's a very useful tool. For the simulation results, we use a workbench, the SimStat to a spreadsheet. So we converted the simulation results to classes. So on the left side we have the photovoltaic potential classes, and on the right side we have the heat demand. And for the building generation we use another workbench which uses some custom transformers. The first custom transformer is a transformer that converts the LOD1 solid buildings to multi-surface. And the reason we did this is because we want to visualize realistically the LOD1 solid. The second custom transformer is an F3 optimizer. So we use this transformer to achieve high frame rates. And the output is one index spaced per diffuse color. So in this example, we have three buildings and the roof surfaces are in one node and one index spaced, and the rest of the geometry, the walls and the ground surfaces, are in second index spaced. For the point of interest generation, we use another workbench. And this is how we generated the points of interest. We forced the roof surface to become a projection in the zero plane. And then we dissolve any kind of lines we have inside the perimeter, and then we calculate the centroid. Then we use the Zmax of the roof surface to force it in the 3D space, and then we can create a marker. In this case we have a cone and above an annotation. So benchmarking, it was a time-costing process. For one city model, around 2,000 part-time buildings, we need around 60 minutes of processing. So to conclude, we follow the workload to generate XD cities using the FME tool. So these are the results. On the left side, we have the realistic representation, which is just a city model with red roofs and white walls and ground surfaces. In the middle, we have the photovoltaic potential. And on the right side, we have the heat demand. So this is a use case. We used models in the touch lab. It's this device you see, which is kind of a large screen with many touch sensors in an energy saving fair. So the civilians could freely access, and they could locate the buildings and check the potential of their houses. I want to especially thank Volker Bruce, Marcel Bruce, and Ruskes Patsala. They also helped me. Thank you.
Your LOD2 the roof's form are generated automatically, or you measure it manually?
The hands.
A hand, okay.
A related question is the information for the rooftops, is it resolution is enough, or you just basically generate a triangular shaped roof?
No, the building cells were provided already. We didn't generate anything.
Including the roof shape?
Yeah, everything. We have cases. Actually, the data sets were LOD2, but we had, in the LOD2 data sets, we had LOD1 buildings. And the reason is that when we cannot calculate the roof surface of a building, when this is not possible, then an LOD1 building is generated. So it's a kind of, I would say, a flaw or something in the process of generating the city models.
Let's get underway. I'll start with the first paper of this session. Dr. Hamza Lip, one of our program chairs, is be presenting some of his work on patient-specific 3D surfaces and medical planning. So.
Thank you, Nicholas. This application of X3D is targeted towards medical simulation and training. It could be also used towards, it can be actually used in a clinical setup, in an educational setup for students' education, medical training, as I said, or even patient education. I'm going to provide a brief background and motivation for the project. The project has been going on for several years now, and I'm going to present some updates on this project. Look a little bit at the related work, surface scanning very briefly, technology, hardware and software, and I'm going to provide a very brief review of the 3D RTT, which stands for 3D Radiation Therapy Training, the acronym. Proposed scanning system. Based on a Microsoft Kinect cameras, infrared configuration scenarios, brief description of the methodology for accuracy assessment, and then also some information about data processing and optimization that we have done to improve the system. So first of all, a little bit about the background on the problem. Radiation therapy is used for cancer treatment. It's actually one of the main methods that's used in conjunction with other methods like chemotherapy and surgery. Roughly 50 to 60% of cancer patients are treated with radiation at different stages. It's a fairly complex procedure. Basically what happens is X-ray and more currently protons are applied on the cancerous tissues. The idea is that the radiation destroys the cell, the cancerous cell ability to reproduce. And in this way, the body gets rid of the cancerous cells. There are two major directions, well, actually more than two, but for specifically for external beam radiation therapy systems, when you use external radiation sources rather than embedded sources, there are two directions, X-ray therapy, using X-rays basically, and proton therapy. The main difference between the two approaches is the fact that in X-ray therapy you have an entry and an exit dose. The X-ray basically penetrates the body, and obviously not only the tumorous tissue or the cancerous tissue is affected, but also the healthy tissue is affected. So in general, when we do X-ray therapy, there are many angles used for the ray in such a way that the intersection of the rays are covering mainly the cancerous tissue. So the cancerous tissue is exposed to higher levels of radiation than the healthy tissue. As opposed to X-ray therapy, proton therapy, the energy of protons is can be controlled actually much at a much finer level. So the protons can be actually, the cancerous tissue can be bombarded with protons without the need of an exit ray. So we have only an entry ray. Obviously, immediately reducing in half the exposure to the healthy tissue to radiation. I know there are maybe debates on the efficiency of the proton therapy on X-ray or X-ray therapy. I'm by far not an expert at these methods. So I'm not going to comment on the efficiency of these methods. However, X-ray therapy has been used and is in use quite a bit, and it seems like proton therapy is also a fairly or is increasing basically as frequency in terms of use. The equipment used for both it's quite complex. It needs a calibration procedure. It's obviously quite expensive. The calibration procedure actually takes time. On the right side, you have a picture of a general flow for external radiation therapy treatments, which usually starts with the CT scanning. The part of the body that is affected is basically set up under a CT scanner. The CT scanner itself generates radiation, so it will actually add to the radiation dose of the patient. So in general, a full body CT scan is not recommended. Once you have the data from the CT scanner, you basically have the slices, and that is usually combined in the treatment planning system and the radiation angles as well as the doses are calculated. The treatment planning system sends out basically a list of angles and doses that are further verified by the dosimetrist and by the medical team that is in charge of the treatment. Now, one of the issues that we have with this is that the treatment planning system does not provide any kind of information in terms of collision between the patient, body parts, and components of the system, of the hardware system. Now, here is an example. You can see on the left corner a linear accelerator, basically, that's quite heavy, a couple of tons, and it's rotating around the table. And you can see on the zoom out on the image quite a lot of damage from collisions. Now, most of these collisions have not been with the patient, but with other components, either the table or with devices that are attached to the patient. However, if a 3-ton device comes within centimeters to your face, it's not really comforting. So the team usually tries to avoid these types of close encounters. But they cannot see that in the treatment planning system. More than that, the body of the patient, the shape of the body of the patient changes when the patient lays down, and there is no information about the body of the patient, actually. So what they are using currently, well, you know, before we came up with this idea, they actually were using pillows to do a dry run. But then even if you want to do a dry run, you have to close the door, you have to isolate the room. The room has special walls, and it takes quite a lot of time. And if there is any collision, or any potential collision between the device and between the components of the device, between the device and the patient, then the whole plan has to be redone. Now, changing angles means also changing doses. So the team has to get together again, and you know everything has to change. So that takes quite a lot of time. Especially for more complex procedures that involve neck or head tumors, there are special devices, attachment devices that are added to the patient, like you can see in the picture on the right side. And these special devices sometimes are significant sources of collision. So what we try to do with this project, we try to provide a simulation tool for a realistic representation of the treatment room, which with as much detail and resolution as possible. We try to provide an interactive tool, so you can configure the room, you can check on the angles, you can visualize different system components. The main components of the systems are the table, the collimator, and several devices that are attached, as well as the beam shape. The collimator has a leaf, basically, that can shape the radiation ray under different, providing different shapes. And we also wanted to have a simple web-based interface to facilitate collaboration in terms of complex procedures that require expert review and try to reduce in this way the overhead of traveling. And by having a fairly simple system device in the browser, we aim at reducing the cognitive load required by the team. So there's no need to kind of learn anything new. You can just use the browser and run the simulation. Now, let me mention that the clinical use for this tool has not been approved yet. We do have roughly 1,000 users on the system in the last more than 7 years now. It can be obviously be used for teaching, and has been used so, and also for patient education. You know, sometimes the patient has no idea what kind of procedure they have to go through, and when they enter the room, they kind of freak out. So somebody has to explain what's going to happen. As I said, these devices are quite heavy, quite big, and they can be quite intimidating. And the people that go through these kind of treatments are not in their best shape anyway. So, you know, trying to avoid more stress on them, it's a good idea to provide them at least a brief overview of how the system will work to try to remove some of the fears. So as I mentioned, the related work, the 3D RTT system has been released in 2007. And it's an X-ray therapy simulator. You have the website at the bottom there. We use the Beat Contact Player to actually play as a plugin in the browser. It was quite buggy for a while. Things are getting better and better right now. So should work fairly well with any browser at this point. We had two systems, a simulation for two systems, X-ray therapy systems, the Varian Trilogy and a Novalis Brain Lab component. The hardware models were quite accurate. We used a conic aminota scanner to actually obtain the surface models. We use actually many web methods. We also did from photometry. However, so far we already had a generic patient model. So the generic patient model obviously does not cover all the cases. So what we wanted to achieve is we want real-time 3D patient models. So the surface of the patient, the skin of the patient, basically the surface of the patient. To be able to embed it in real time in the simulator. Now, of course, patients have different shapes. Sometimes the position of the body for specific cases, they have to move their hands or limbs, so they have to sit in a specific or lay down in a specific position. We also wanted to have an inexpensive and reconfigurable solution, so we look at infrared, basically cameras, scanning cameras, and arrays of cameras, basically, to be able to play with different resolutions. On the right side, you have a table that shows you the operating range, frame speed, accuracy of several scanner types, Kinect, Microsoft Kinect, the second version, and so on. Of course, there is a lot of hardware and software that deals with scanning. Depending on the case, you can scan entire buildings or very small objects with different resolutions. Our proposed scanning system was the Microsoft Kinect. We looked at Microsoft Kinect, the first and the second version. One of the main advantages of the second version is the fact that it has slightly better accuracy. So you can see the RMS error, the maximum error there, the average deviation also. The problem with the second version is that it does not have the little engine that allows tilting of the camera. So Microsoft decided to remove that tilting factor, which in our case was quite useful because we wanted to scan an entire patient body. And for that reason, we had to actually use several cameras rather than just one. So here are some of the configuration scenarios. Of course, we tried initially with the patient standing. And having the Kinect camera, you have the distance there in millimeters, roughly a meter away. With three Kinect cameras, trying to get the sides and the front face. The back of the patient usually is not important because you know it lays on the table anyway. Once we were playing with these scenarios, the stand-up scenario, we even had the patient, you know, sitting on a rotating platform, all kinds of things. We realized it's actually not a good idea because depending on the patient body type, when the patient lays down, the body will deform differently, actually. And that's usually the case for more heavy patients. So we finally went with the obvious approach, having the patient lay down. and with two Kinect systems on the side connecting the data, and then later we added two more to have the full body, so four Kinect cameras in the end. Of course, there's a calibration procedure involved. We went with a general calibration procedure. It's nothing really, really complex. That's just a shot of the setup in the lab. So my students were able to scan several people, and we scanned the dean of the psychology department, who's a little bit, you know, bigger in size. So we want to have different kind of sizes to check on things. With quite a lot of data processing and optimization, what you can see here on the right side is the quality map using a single Microsoft Kinect, and you can see error rates varying from 1 millimeter to 5 millimeters. Of course, because of the position of the Microsoft Kinect, you get some kind of gaps in the point cloud. That's pretty much a scan of me laying down, and you can see in front. There's quite a lot of gaps. We had to kind of fill that. So, I don't have enough time. Yeah, I know. Then, for processing and optimization to compress the data, because you really want to send the data up fast, we use the X3D binary format, and there's quite a lot of work that I've seen today. So, I think we can improve that side significantly, and we try to kind of keep things moving fast. In terms of decimation versus accuracy, we try to keep the error roughly at sub-centimeter level. So having 5 to 10 scans and combining the information, we can offer an error, a maximum error as low as 10 millimeters, which is about 1 centimeter. Obviously, this is what we got as a threshold from the medical personnel that was working with us on the system. So they said if it's a 1 centimeter a maximum error, that should be enough for our system. So these are just some screenshots. Feel free to go on the website and download the BitContact player. You can actually play with the system. I set up a generic username, web3d2015, and the password is guest. Or you can also send a registration. I'd like to acknowledge my students that work on the project, Shane and Eric, and our research collaborator from MLS Sarkassa Foundation, who's now the chief phototherapist at the University of Florida Health Center. And you have more details about the project, you can email me, and I can check the website. Sorry, I'm running out of time. Do you have any questions? Yes.
You said five, I didn't understand when you said 5 to 10 scans.
When you said 5 to 10 scans,
yeah,
you have to each 5 to 10 separate sittings where you scan with a Kinect.
No, the patient stays, you know, he sits down one time, and you know, the scanning system will basically run 5 times, and I collect data from all 4 systems, and then I combine it.
How do you what did you use to combine all the Kinect?
We have actually a small program that we do to combine the meshes. Everything is very well calibrated. Basically, the table where the patient is sitting is an optical table. So once you calibrate the system, nothing really moves. It's sub-millimeter accuracy. But of course, you know, our wood bench, we have to calibrate it over and over again, because once the person, you know, stands up, moves things around a little bit, you know. But in the real scenario, once you attach the cameras on the optical table, nothing will really move. I mean, it's going to be really, really solid. Yeah, so, thank you.
All right, thanks again. All right.
Excellent, thank you. Our next paper presentation here from Finian will be presenting remote visualization of dynamic molecular data using WebGL. And thank you. You're ready to begin.
Yeah. Thank you. Yeah, my name is Finian, and I'm going to talk about remote visualization of molecular dynamic data using WebGL. So. Yeah, our motivation is that we wanted to do remote visualization. And usually remote visualization itself is modeled as a pipeline. You have from the raw data, you have to do some pre-processing, and the eventual step is the rendering. And so when we say remote visualization is that some part of that pipeline is running on a different machine, where normal, in the normal case, all the steps run in one machine. So why we do remote visualization is that sometimes the data is too big that you can't download everything and do your visualization in your machine. Or sometimes the machine is not capable enough to do the rendering. That's why you have to divide the pipeline. So another one is that, okay, we want also to support many mobile devices. And given that we have multiple devices, that's why we're interested on WebGL, because we can just use many devices from smartphones to laptops and desktops. And since we have already a framework which is currently just supporting the desktop platform, so we just wanted to add this as a front end to the existing framework. So the molecular data is usually is a result of simulations from ND simulations, which are used by molecular scientists and biochemists. They do simulations to understand how the proteins interact with time. And yeah, these simulations are used even for drug companies, which want to see how the drug and the protein where it's going to interact with work. So it's a dynamic time-varying data, which after the simulation ends is written on the usually in a, just a file in a file system, and then you load the file, and then you can like sort of replay the time variation and see how the conformation of the proteins vary over time. So for the web, we had some existing, we looked at some existing tools. Of course, we have the common one is JMOL, which is uses some plugins. And there is another one, which is JSMOL, that is a pure JavaScript implementation, just to avoid the problems with the plugin, the security issues with plugins, and sometimes you have to keep on updating the plugin, so that you can work well with your browser. But the problem with the JSMOL is it's limited to smaller data sets. You can't visualize large data sets. And another thing that existing tools use triangle meshes. And for visualizing these molecular data sets, each atom of the molecule is modeled as a sphere. So if you want to have a smooth surface of a sphere, you have to generate so many triangles so that you can have that smooth surface. That one is costly, and sometimes it gives a lower quality image compared, of course, to another technique which uses the implicit surface precasting. I will describe what that is. So our solution is based on WebGL plus HTML5 standards, so we don't need plugins. And of course, it's capable of visualizing live data sets, interactive framework, because when you have like that, of course, the user needs to interact here, zooming, panning, and changing the view of the, so that you can see the 3D view of the molecule. And of course, we use GPU-based ray casting so that we can have faster rendering and obtain the smooth surfaces. So this is our architecture. Of course, this is a simplified version of what we have detailed in the paper, but for the sake of presentation, just made this simplified version so that you can see how, the overview of the ecosystem. So at the beginning, the client sends just a normal HTTP request to the server. And that request, of course, will contain what kind of molecule you want to visualize. And then on the server side, of course, depending on what you want, it will send back the HTML for your user interface, the JavaScript files, which, of course, part of that is the scripts which will be interacting with the GPU for rendering. And of course, you have the shaders, because with implicit surface recasting, most of the work is done on the GPU by writing shaders. So once this, of course, once this data is sent by the HTTP server, and then the control has to go to the WebSocket server for listening for any communications with the WebSocket part. So on the client side, once the JavaScript files have been received, and one of the JavaScript will connect back to the server using the WebSocket connection, and then that's where the data transfer happens. So here are the key web technologies we have used, is that we have used the web worker in order to decouple the data fetching and the rendering thread. Because if we do that in the main thread, then if you have longer, because network operations are always longer, so it will take a lot of time and maybe the user interface can be non-responsive. And then we use the system client server connection using the WebSocket so that at any time, the server and the client can communicate. Because of course we use sort of a hybrid approach where the pre-processing part is done on the server, and once it's done, then the actual rendering is done on the client. And of course we use binary data so that we have efficient transformation. We avoid this text-based performance because it will be costly to do the processing in the client. And of course, another thing is that the way the web, we use web workers so that, as I said, to decouple the fetching and the rendering. But the communication between the main thread and the web worker is only through message passing because the way they are implemented, they don't share any memory. So we used another feature which is currently supported in the web browser, the transferable objects, where once the web worker has already done its job, and then it transfers the ownership of the memory pointer, whatever, to the main thread so that the main thread can use. So there is no copying, because otherwise if you copy a lot of data between the web worker and the rendering thread, then you will have some problems. So this is the data structure, which is transferred from the server to the client. And this is just simply an array buffer, because the WebSockets nowadays, they support text data and binary data. On the binary data, you have the blob and the array buffer. So in our case, we use an array buffer because this is very compact and GPU friendly. That once you have received the data, you just upload it to the GPU without much processing. Because doing much processing on the client side, and that we'll be doing in JavaScript, which will definitely be not very efficient. So. Of course, the details of all this data which we are sending is detailed and described in our paper, and how we use this dependent. Mainly is the sphere data, which we use on the GPU to generate the spheres. And of course, sometimes you want the surface of the protein, and then you can send the triangles. But for the atoms, for the sphere, we just send the atoms. So, it's a general overview of how raycasting is, GPU-based raycasting is done. And for the WebGL, we have just two stages of where you can write your program to do something. So you have the matrix shader and you have the fragment shader. So for those who are working with the web, OpenGL in desktops, not all the pipelines, programmer pipelines, the stages you are aware of are not available in the WebGL. So you can just do something on the vertex shader and fragment shader. So on the vertex shader, you just render a full scale quad just to initiate the rendering pipeline. And for this case, on the vertex shader, we just transform the quad so that it always faces the camera, because when we do the ray casting, the rays are from the eye position. So because you will be rotating and sort of things, so you have to ensure that it always faces the camera. And on the fragment shader, we just compute the view ray, that's the ray from the eye position to the center of the fragment. And then you do the ray casting, ray sphere intersection. And of course for the sphere, if there is an intersection, there's a possibility that you can have just one, or you have two, but you just return the closest one. And then you need to write the depth value. And this, you need an extension. So now this variable is a GL drag frag depth ext. It's an extension you need to enable so that you can be able to write the depth buffer in the fragment shader. So this is another technique which we just it was mainly just for feasibility testing, but these techniques are already in the desktop, but we wanted to see how if we can do that in the web, because people say, okay, we have these techniques, but can we do that, and if that, how? So the default shading, the general idea is that you separate the rendering of the geometry from shading computations, like lighting and all those things. But for our case, because we just have a single light, so lighting computations are not that much, but we just wanted to do that so that we can have the pre-processing. Because like these toon shading techniques, they need to, I mean, you need more than one rendering pass. So you render the first pass, you render the frame depth object, and then on the second, you can use that data as texture so that you can do whatever post-processing techniques you want. And this also requires the web GL draw buffer extension, so that you, because this supports that you can attach so many color buffers. I think the maximum now is 4. You can attach maximum of 4 color buffers, so that you can, otherwise it will be very expensive. So we used also screen space ambient occlusion based on kajaling technique. For this, you just compute the occlusion factor based on the data which was already in the frame buffer. And then we do the Gaussian blur just to smooth the, I mean, to remove the noises of the, from the rendered image, because this kajaling technique has a problem that it introduces some noises. So if you don't remove the noise, then your image will not look good. So you have to do the Gaussian blur so that you can remove the introduced noises. And then the twin shading technique, we just use the technique by Saito and Kahash, where they just, you just need to compute the depth gradient. So because the depth information you already have on the frame buffer, and then just compute the depth gradient. Because the depth gradient helps to be able to identify the edges. So, and so these are our results. So the first technique, as I said, like our data structure supports like sending these spheres, sphere data, of which you use on the GPU to recast and generate the spheres, and that you can also send triangles. So for this, that means you can combine both. Like you can send the sphere data and generate the spheres on the GPU, and also the triangles, just render them as normal frame, so we can combine both. And on the second, which is this, so yeah, so this one, here like you're just sending the triangles. You don't need, if you don't, you just want this surface, and then you don't need this spheres, you can just send the triangles. And on this one, if you don't want the surface, then you can just send the sphere. So this, of course, in the data structure, they show that you're the somewhere where you show how many spheres you're sending and how many triangles you're sending. So if you don't send any, you just put that as zero. So here I put some as very short video, just for the sake of time, that okay, you can visualize and still you can also interact. So it's just not a one direction that you can just can view as a movie. No, I mean, you can run in real time and then you can zoom. It's like want to interact while the simulation is running. So this is also possible, like for if you can connect directly with the data which is coming from the simulation and monitor the simulation as it is running. So this is our performance data. So we had two test cases. One we used the LAN connection, normal LAN connection, and the other one was wireless, because we are interested with the transfer times and the rendering times, because interactivity, we have to reduce the latency. So these are the data which we got. So the maximum molecule we could render was for the, our test case was having 1.3 million atoms. And yeah, the sizes are as shown in the last column. And of course, the LAN transfer is much better than the Wi-Fi one. And these are the rendering. So for, of course, we had the normal PC and laptop. So for the laptop, we tested it both for LAN and for Wi-Fi, but for PC, of course, just the LAN. And these are the frame rates we got, so we could still achieve even for the most largest protein, we could achieve interactive frame rates. So as FutureWeb, okay, we are aiming for the cloud that we could support many users. And so our FutureWeb will now concentrate on the server side because we know that, okay, on the render, on the client side, we can already render this. So we know, want to support more users and maybe more larger data sets. And of course, for sharing and collaboration, it's important that you can have some space where many users can access data and all those stuff. So a summary that, okay, we have, well, we demonstrated that we can achieve visualization of large dynamic data sets at interactive frame rates. But of course, these are the key techniques, key web technologies which are enabling to be able to do that together. We need a WebGL, because with these extensions. But of course, most of the important extensions we have used now with the WebGL 2, they are already on the core. So they are enabled. And of course, WebSockets, WebWebHealth, and Type Arrays are the important enabling web standards which allow us to do that. And of course, another take home message that, of course, demanding computations to be uploaded on the server. So that's why we need to have these persistent communications that whenever the server has done something, just immediately communicates with the client for rendering. You don't need to establish new connections. Of course, we see that there's a very big potential for web-based collaboration given the growing support of the WebGL. Like, we want also to try to see the real-time web technology, web RTC technologies, and of course, there's some improvement on the JavaScript engine. So thank you, and I welcome you.
Great, do we have any questions?
Have you considered solvent surfaces to be integrated in your workflow?
Sorry?
Have you considered the display of the solvent surface? You know, for this molecular models, what biologists are always interested in is the solvent surface with superimposed potential fields.
Yes, our technique does that, but of course we didn't show everything. Because, like, of course, for the surfaces, we have these generated tools which generate this molecular surface already, so we can just send those data as plain, or maybe.
And you do that in real time, because then you're talking about serious amount of triangles, or?
Oh no, the triangles have to be generated as a pre-processing step, so that, I mean, you just have to load them and send them. Because if you generate the triangles or the surface when the request is coming, definitely there will be some latches. So that means on the server side, you need to have all those triangles ready, and then when the request is received, then you just have to send it.
And then you don't have a problem with real time?
Sorry?
You don't have a problem with real time? Large models means, we're talking about a few millions of triangles. If you approximate the alpha shapes quite accurately, it's 10 to the whatever power of triangles, right? And then real time is a bit in jeopardy, isn't it?
Yeah, definitely. Sending so many triangles would be a challenge at first.
Unless sort of you have a data structure behind it, you don't just push all the triangles to the client, because you might be killing a triangle very easily with a complex model.
Yes, and even like the interaction model, what we are using here is that the client is the one which is driving the server. Like whenever it has sent the raw call to the GPU, and then it requests new data, not just the server pushing the data to the client. So another technique probably would be to just send the few data as possible. Because like if you have a very big model, you don't, I mean, we don't assume that the user will be able to see the whole model at once. So that means you can concentrate on a certain area of interest and then just request the data for that particular.
Okay, but you haven't tried that. You're just...
No, we haven't tried that.
Thank you.
So that is the feature that we want to concentrate more on the server side.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Great. Okay, we'll do a couple of more and then maybe Christoph, if you want to step up and prepare for the presentation.
I was just wondering, so for your raycaster, you have to initiate the draw call per sphere, isn't it?
Sorry?
For the raycaster,
yeah.
You have to do one draw call per sphere.
No, no, we don't do that. I mean, we send the data as a vertex buffer, and then you just now draw the full screen quad. And then do the recasting. So it's, you don't have to loop in the
one glance. Okay.
So it's, it's done per pixel. So
because in the picture it looked like that you have the proxy object is just for a single sphere. So I was just wondering.
Ah, okay. Yeah, this one was just for a single instance of the.
Okay.
Otherwise. That would be very costly.
Okay. Yeah. Thanks.
It's just a modified sphere shader.
Thanks, very interesting talk. Brief question. You skimmed over, you mentioned that the more details in the paper about how you, the coding you used for the binary formats because you're transferring spheres and triangles.
Yeah.
Have you tried to apply any efficiency savings in that coding format? Have you tried reducing the bit depth or have you tried doing some simple compression you can use to try and reduce the amount of data you're transferring in? Would that speed things up on the data transfer side?
Yes, definitely. We have put that as a feature that we want to consider some compression. Although, of course, there's some trade-off with compression that if you do a lot of compression, then of course the client will have to decompress that.
Yeah, but there's a difference between compressing and reducing precision.
Yeah, yeah.
32 to 16-bit compression.
Yeah.
16-bit complexity.
Yeah.
You don't compress at all, but you just lose a bit of precision. I wonder with the spheres, whether you need that 32 bits worth of data,
where
you can get with 16 bits, half the amount of data.
That's on our future work that we want to see how we can pack a lot of that data simple. Because as now we are sending everything as floats, so definitely 4 bytes is much. So if we can use fewer than that for our elements, then we can save a lot of space.
Great. Good questions and suggestions. Thanks. Super. Okay. So now Christoph Balzac will be presenting the full paper on semantic query-based generation of customized 3D scenes. Welcome back. Thank you.
Thank you, Nicholas, for this kind introduction. I come from the Department of Information Technology at the Poznan University of Economics, and the paper I'm going to present today touches one of the aspects of a much larger project. We're aiming at the semantic modeling of interactive 3D content in web, VR, and AR environments. And this particular aspect I'm going to describe today is semantic query-based customization of 3D content. It's a very important thing to consider. The presentation outline the following. I will start with motivation, then I will shortly describe the semic approach which enables semantic modeling of iterative 3D content. Then I will focus on the query-based content customization, provide some examples, implementation, and conclusions. So, starting from the motivation, as we all know here in this room, we are facing tremendous opportunities for widespread use of interactive 3D content. Progress in hardware, software, standards, networks, everything contributes to the possibility of using 3D in many application domains, such as cultural heritage, education, medicine, tourism. It's just enough to look at the names of the sessions at this conference to see how much of them are there. However, the problem is that creation of interactive 3D web content is a challenging task. The content is more complex than other types of media, You need to describe geometry, structure, space, appearance, animation, and behavior. Elements must be considered in this process. So the challenge in 3D content creation comes from, first of all, from the high complexity of the content. The process requires proper tools and experience in this field. There is a multitude of content presentation platforms, even if you use common standards, the platforms will differ, which require adaptation of the content. And the process is expensive and time-consuming. Moreover, applicability of content which is ready to use is limited. In many application domains, you need personalization of the content or adaptation of the content. Personalization means customization to select elements which are only of interest for you, for example, visualization, teaching, cultural heritage. Adaptation means adjusting the content to different presentation platforms and contexts. Moreover, to make things more difficult, content creation and customization in most application domains must be performed by domain experts, by the curator in a museum, by the teacher in school, by the salesman in a virtual shop, who don't need to be experts in 3D modeling and programming. So efficient methods for creation and customization of 3D content are required. Therefore, this challenge has received a lot of attention from the researcher community over the years. A number of solutions, such as specialized tools and applications, high-level languages and frameworks, templates, parametrization, componentization, have been considered to solve this problem. They are successful to some extent, but they provide limited possibilities of facilitating content creation and customization. So the problem we are facing is the lack of solutions for flexible, on-demand content creation customization, which would enable consideration of explicit and explicit knowledge in different aspects at different levels of abstraction. One of the possible solutions to this problem is semantic modeling of 3D content. Semantic modeling can be seen as extension and generalization of the previous approaches. It enables declarative and knowledge-based content creation and arbitrary choosing conceptual levels of abstraction. It enables content representation which is independent of particular presentation platforms and simplifies content management through indexing, searching, analyzing of content components. So the approach which we have developed for semantic modeling of 3D content is called SEMIC. And the approach divides the content pipeline into several stages. In the first stage, based on semantic content model, we are creating a generalized content representation, and this generalized content representation is called semantic 3D meta scene. In some cases, this can be a scene, but in general case, it's not a scene. I will describe this later in more details. Then, based on this generalized representation, we are using semantic content customization patterns to customize the content through specific queries. And by customization of the content, we are obtaining customized content representation. And this is our main focus today. Then, based on the customized content representation, the semantic content model and 3D representation language knowledge, we are able to build the final content representation, which is specific to a particular platform, and which can be visualized on a specific hardware and software. So let's start with the semantic content model just very shortly. As I said, the main intention of this semantic modeling work here I'm describing is to enable domain experts to create content. And domain experts think and work in domain using domain concepts. So we take this domain concept and put it into domain-specific ontology. This can be basically any ontology which is used in a particular application field, at museum, at shops, at teaching facilities, etc. On the other hand, we have specific representation of content through a model which we have developed, multi-layered semantic content model, which describes in details how particular content elements should be presented. And between these two ontologies, the domain-specific ontology and ontology for representation of content, there is the important element of semantic mapping. Semantic mapping which tells how domain-specific concepts map to particular elements of the 3D environment. So through modeling, we need to create three things. We need to create the concrete content representation. This can be through scanning, through modeling, through programming, usually done by programmers and designers. We have also representation mapping, which is also performed by designers, which tell how conceptual elements are represented using this concrete representation. And we have the green part. It's green because it's done by domain experts. It should be the easiest to do. Using domain-specific concepts, domain experts should be able to create content, and through the mapping, the representation will be created automatically, generated by the system. So this is the overview of the SENIC model. The important element to consider looking at the customization and generation of content is the semantic mapping model. Semantic mapping model enables presentation of domain-specific concepts by mapping them to the concrete elements, and it includes generic concepts for wrapping domain-specific ontologies. And these generic concepts, simplifying a bit, are in four categories: presentable objects, properties, descriptors, and relations. Presentable objects is basically what you see, what you feel, and what you hear in the environment. Everything which is explicitly presented. So this can be artifacts in a museum, avatars in game, cars in a car show, etc. Properties represent conceptual features of presentable objects, such as material, color, shininess, etc. Descriptors are containers collecting multiple properties, because in real life it is easier to have containers for sets of properties instead of particular elements. So descriptive classes for containers of properties with values fixed for its whole class, and descriptive individuals for specific values for particular instances. And finally, relations, which provide dependencies between properties and different presentable objects, for example, relative allocation. So now I would like to introduce the semantic 3D meta scene and the content customization patterns. Semantic 3D meta scene is a customizable 3D content representation, a knowledge base generated within the semantic content model. It has four properties. It's flexible because it represents content both low and high levels of abstraction. So we know what shapes will be there, and we know what does it mean for the domain expert. It is generalized because it represents a superset of the presentable content. It is abstract because it does not need to specify all elements which are required for presentation. And it's extensible because new elements may be added to the meta scene to create final 3D scene. So if you look at these properties, you immediately see that it is not possible to render a meta scene, right? In some cases, when it's not generalized, it's not abstract, you may be able to render a meta scene, but in general case not. And the semantic content query, which we use for customization of the content, is a knowledge base which is built according to semantic content customization patterns. And there is a number of patterns, and they fall into four categories: selection, projection, extension, and composition. Selection is indication of particular presentable objects which are being included in the scene. Individual selector for explicit selection, class selector for implicit selection, rule selector for semantically complex queries, and complex class selector for intersection, for difference, and this kind of logical operation. So if we look at the structure of a meta scene, we have the presentable objects, we have some properties indicated as literals here, we have property descriptors, we have relationships between the objects. So the selection indicates the presentable objects which should be presented. This is the most simple operation of customization. Projection indicates the desirable features or behavior of presentable objects that are to be presented. There is a sub-projector for presenting a particular property for all objects, super projector for explicit choice for specific objects, and conditional for projector enabling selection by rules. So if you combine selection and projection, you have both the presentable objects and you have features and relationships, properties and relationships between the objects. Extension and composition enable introduction of new content elements to the scene. Extension introduces new properties for describing object, and composition introduces new relations for combining selected presentable objects by specifying mutual dependencies. Both explicit and implicit cases are possible here. I'm not going to details for the lack of time. So So if you consider the extension mechanism here, you see new properties marked in blue, which were in the, which were introduced by this operation. If you look at composition, there is new relationship which connects the two presentable objects. For example, provide the relative distance list. So if you combine all the elements, selection, projection, extension, and composition, you can flexibly customize the meta scene to generate a 3D virtual scene, which is then going to be present. So looking at examples, so this is a meta scene. As I said, meta scene cannot be rendered, but just for the sake of presentation, we made some simplification, and this is a not exact, but average representation of a meta scene. The code you can see here is not full code; it's a fragment of code. It's a RDF turtle notation, which describes the contents of the meta scene. Then, using particular queries, you can make real customized 3D scenes based on this 3D meta scene. So in the first query, we use the global selector, and we use the global selector. So we are selecting everything and all objects and all properties. And we add specific rules which put objects on their stands. So there are semantic rules which make the object standing on particular places. In the second query example, we just select clay objects, which means that we use a specific selector, which is a clay object selector, which restricts the objects only to those objects which are made of clay. And we also select appropriate stands for the objects. In the third query, which refines the previous query, we add another condition, which means that the only artifacts with a maximum distance between them will be selected for presentation. So there is a simple rule which just adds the condition that the distance between the objects will be maximal for the objects to be presented. There is another case of adding interaction through the extension, but I'm not going to go into details. Please look in the paper. There are more examples. The system that we have implemented is based on client-server architecture for multi-user design of the system and for sharing the content. The client is built as a Blender application plus Python extension, and server is developed in Java. So this is how the content authoring looks like. Obviously, we don't want users to write web ontology language, this description of the scene. So this is what we use, this kind of tool. Now, this is a Blender tool with Blender generic editing tools. And there is a special set of tools added here on the left side, which enable all stages of the content authoring. The high-level conceptual design, the representation mapping, the low-level concrete design, and the customization elements. So this is the customization tool, which enables generation of the scene using specific query patterns. In a typical research scenario, this may be performed by different kinds of applications. So depending on the application domain, the query will be generated by the application to provide appropriate content to the user. So here are some examples developed using the tool that we have just presented. This is a set of city models. They are not meant to be realistic. It's just for the sake of presentation of the capability. So here we select some specific trees. We select some specific cars in the roads. We select the cars with specific features, and we select specific signs and types of cars. So to conclude, I have presented a method of semantic modeling, a semantic customization of the content. The presented approach enables complex content customization mechanism. It operates on a high level of abstraction, enables use of indirect knowledge in the content authoring, which is a very important element, simplifying content creation and querying. You don't have to consider all particular cases. You may do generic statements about the content. It is platform and standard independent and is compliant with the semantic web standards. The future works include implementation of the remaining content generation patterns in the tool, evaluation in terms of size and complexity of the 3D content, on-demand generation of rule-based description of content behavior, because this is not yet implemented, support for the four-dimensional time-space, including time, and support for context for personalization and adaptation of 3D content. Thank you very much for your attention. I'll be happy to answer questions.
Has been already evaluated, and this was published in some journal publications. And we have indicated that the approach is both qualitatively and quantitatively superior to the previous approaches, because it enables more efficient generation of content. The representation of content is smaller, and the functional set of features is higher. Here, what I meant in this point is evaluation of the customization elements. So how you compare customization using this set of tools and functionality to other forms of customization, such as, for example, componentization with parameters, or templates-based approaches, or specific applications. So this kind of evaluation I mean here.
Yeah, thanks. And as a follow-up, have you considered also the learning effort in your system? Because I guess you will require
the main point here is to shorten the learning time, because the domain experts, because there are several types of people involved in the content design. If you cannot kill entropy, so you have to divide the process into several stages. We do the programming in one stage, we do the design in another stage, and we do the creation of content by domain experts at the third stage. And we assume that there will be specific users for this specific authoring phases. So for the domain experts, the obvious thing is that we want to use the domain-specific ontology for them, not to have to learn specific 3D geometry programming-related things, but just use their own knowledge. So there is an artifact. Artifact is made of clay. Artifact stands in this room. This is the level of abstraction that the domain expert will have to use. Thank you very much.
Okay, so next we have Benny from TU Delft presenting our next paper, which is the procedural generation of interactive web visualization of natural environments. Thanks, Benny, whenever you're ready.
Thank you. So my name is Benny Olbers. I'm a master's student at Delft University. And today I will talk about the generation and visualization of detailed natural environments that you can see in this video. So before I go into detail of how I accomplished this, I'll first talk a little bit about the motivation of my research. So ecologists have a lot of different data about natural environments, such as landscape maps, you can do height maps and so forth, and also coverage of plant species, which basically means how much plants are there for a certain plant species in an environment, and the patchiness of plant species. This is also important because this defines how certain patterns of certain plant species lie in the environment. So certain plant species are randomly scattered in the environment, while others create large patches or small patches in the environment. And ecologists can get a lot of insight in this data, but they also want to communicate this to other people so they can use it for decision making, promotion of their own work, or promotion of nature in general. And in the bottom you can see some example data. For example, on the left you can see several landscape maps. Interesting to note that these maps are not obtained through remote sensing sources, but they are obtained through ecological models. An ecological model is basically a model that simulates ecological process on an existing map, and return again get a map of how the area looks in the future. So you can see at the different timestamps how the environment evolves over time. The top map is the plant density map, and the bottom is the height map. And well, of course, these maps are not very convincing to other people to understand. So so they want to create a 3D visualization of this. So this is also basically the main question of my research: how can we generate a convincing and correct plant history from this ecological data, and how can we generate to an interactive 3D map visualization? So therefore I developed an approach. Basically, there are two main parts, the vegetation model and the visualization model. The vegetation model uses the data input of which is the ecological data, and transforms it to a plant distribution. And you see an example plant distribution below the vegetation model, which basically is a point distribution with plant species assigned to it. And next, this is transformed to a 3D representation in the visualization model. So I will first start with shortly describing the process of the vegetation model. The vegetation model consists out of two components: the plant position generation and plant species generation. Plant position generation, its aim is just to generate possible plant positions. So we do not assign any plant species yet, it's just possible plant positions. How do we do this? So first, we take a landscape map, which provides us information about various vegetation located. This could be, for example, a biomass map, a density map, an NDVI map, which is a map that measures the greenness of an area. We threshold it in such a way that we obtain a map where we have tells that from which we know there is vegetation in it, and tells where we don't have vegetation. And next, we calculate plant positions in the tiles from which we know there is vegetation. We do this by using the Poisson distribution with one tiling. And this basically means that we get a point distribution with a property that the points have at least a certain minimum distance to each other. So next, we have to assign plant species to these generated plant positions. So for this we are going to use Crawford's data and Patchness data. So the first step is basically just to connect all the ecological data that we have to each point position. Next, we have to represent the different patterns of the plant species. We do this by using a fractal algorithm. And the next slide will show some results of the fractal algorithm, so you can see it visually. And finally, we will assign plant species to two points using the fractal values and the orbit values. So in the case when we have four plant species in the environment, we obtain, each point will have four different fractal values equal to the number of plant species available. And each map is in a different plant species. And as you can see, you can really clearly identify different patterns already. So next, we have to classify these maps to assign plant species to the plant positions. So how do we do this? Well, in general, if we have, for example, if we take the left top map, and we have, for example, 60% coverage for that plant species, we would take the 60% highest spectral values and assign them to that plant species. We do this for each map separately. So we get these maps. But as you already imagined, because we are doing this separately, it means that certain points can have multiple plant species assigned to it. So this means we have conflicts. And these are marked in red in the image on the left. We solve these conflicts by taking, for that position, the plant species that has the highest fractal value, and which gives the image on the right. So next, there's one remaining problem. For the yellow point, 60% coverage, it is possible that due to the conflicts, it has received 50% coverage in the environment. So we still have to do another step. So basically, we will repeat the previous, we first update the corporate values for the remaining points, then we repeat basically this process until the corporate values are met. So you obtain this kind of distribution. And this is going to be used by the visualization model to make a 3D visualization. You're going to do this in three phases. Offline phase is basically just generates the plant models and gives them to the WebGL renderer, because we visualize everything in WebGL using in combination with the 3DS framework. Next, in the pre-computation phase, we organize all the data to also calculate the necessary data for the various level of details for WebGL in two slides. And finally, we render everything to the screen. So, well, you have to use some plant models to gain some detail in the environment. So these are the same plant models that we have used for our demo, also in a video that I will show later. We used L systems to create these models. So next, pre-computation phase. We have to find three levels of detail. So first you have the plant models, which are shown close to the user. We also use billboards, and in the end, when the plants are really far away, you just color the terrain with a color that is representative for that for these plants there. And also during the pre-computation phase, for example, we calculate for a terrain color map which color there should be on that terrain if that level of detail is active. Further, we generate the terrain mesh from height map, and also both for the terrain as well as the plant distribution, we divide it in blocks and store it in a property structure so that we can easily switch between the blocks depending on the distance. The rendering, I will show that with a video. I generated a visualization of the Paulina Polder, which is a location in the Netherlands. This is a salt marsh, which you can find along the coast in the Netherlands. And well, in this visualization, you can already see various different patterns of the plant species. You see very large patterns, but also more white flowers scattered throughout the environment, and also some pink flowers, but these are like, maybe these are not very visible at this distance. And next, the transitions between the various level of details. We have two transitions. The first transition is between the plant models and the billboards. We create this transition by rendering the plant models to one texture and the billboards to another texture, and then we blend both textures based on a calculated alpha value, and which gives us smooth transitions between the plant models and the billboards. The second transition is between the billboards and the terrain color map, and here we just fade out the billboards based on transparency, based on the distance of the user. And finally, the last shot is just to show the detail of the visualization using close-ups of all the plant models in the environment. We all showed this, these environments to the ecologists, and they were very happy with it, especially with the detail you can obtain with this visualization. So that brings me to my conclusions. So first, we have developed a procedural algorithm that's able to generate convincing and correct plant distribution from our various ecological data, such as corporates and patents data. Second, we provide an open source WebGL renderer that is able to 3D visualize the result of this procedural algorithm. And for in the future, we could further integrate the vegetation and visualization model into a single automated pipeline, because currently they're more like separate components where you generate a result for the vegetation model, and then you have to load it in with, for example, with a text file in the visualization. And as a final note, all the video and also a live demo where you can mow yourself in the environment. You can find it on the link, and also the source code is also available there. So thank you for your attention. Super well done. Any questions for Benny?
Just a quick question, the models for the actual planets that you are showing, do you have a database of those planets, or how does it work?
Someone already made some plant models before I working on this project. But I used these as example data to create my own models, because I had to limit the geometry a little bit to... because you use many phases so that it would explode.
Any other questions? I had one about the transitions. I think that's really an interesting piece of going between these levels of detail. Was that based on the user's distance to the model, or maybe about the screen size of the billboard?
Based on the distance to from the user to the model.
Okay, great. Thank you. All right, let's thank Benny again. Okay, I'd like to welcome Federico's here. We're going to do one more paper in this session. Okay, this full paper is titled "The WebGL Virtual Globe for Efficient Forest Production and Planning in Mountainous Areas." And I believe, if I'm not mistaken, you had some folders or pamphlets out in the front about the project as well?
Yeah, this this project that is a part of a more huge project financed by the European Commission is about the optimization of the this project is about is a part of a more wide project to the whole chain for the optimization of the forest production in mountain area, and is financed by the EU. So a short introduction of my presentation about the motivation and the goals of the project, and in particular of this WebGL virtual representation of the forest system, the architecture that we develop and deploy for the virtual system, and the technology, the overview of the world client and the features that we implement in the client. And so a live demo or probably a video due to the some issue on the net. So the forest in mountain area are 23% of the total earth forest, and so there are several particular specific characteristics of the forest in the mountain respect to the plant forest in the flat area, because we have to conserve the environment that is typically is a touristic zone, and so there are some difficulties in assessing the area. The roads are not so big, and so there is some limitation that imply some several steps on the chain, starting from the planning of which tree to cut and to harvest, passing to the operational on cutting and collecting the tree, storing the tree in a place, and then follow all the logs during the processing chain.
So the goal of our project, of our client, is to develop methodologies and tools in order to support the planning and the both in terms of selecting the appropriate tree that should be marked on the field and then cut it, and also to planning the extraction phase. So for this purpose, we selected to have a very useful tools that could be run on the web, because there are several desktop applications that are typically complicated and use a lot of, have many features, but for the people that work on forest, probably they need some more intuitive and easy to use application that we can deploy on the web, also because there is a lot of background data that otherwise everyone should have on their machine. And so why the 3D? Because in the mountain area, so the 3D dimension for this purpose is very important. So the architecture of our system is a typically service-oriented architecture. We set up a central database that we have called the Forest Information System, in which all the information about the forest and the single tree will be loaded, and also in the right part of the schema there are some information that are more related to the on-field work that are not considered at the moment in our platform, because our platform at the moment is just for planning and managing information. Then we have a layer that for interchange the information between the client and the central database. We have different kind of service, someone that are standard service provided, for instance, using GeoServer for providing maps, image, orthophoto, and some specific service to query directly the 3D the free database on using the client. And then there is the 3D planning system, a mobile and other applications, but we concentrate on the 3D planning system. That it's based on Cesium platform, that is a virtual globe based on WebGL that has several architectural layer, and we made a customization. Okay, of course, from the top, in order to customize the interface and the feature of the client, but we arrive through the scene level, because we have to draw directly new object on the scene, implement the visualization of other object using the Cesium features. So, starting from the client, have two different level of abstraction. The first level is have the possibility to visualize the typical 2D maps like cadastral data or orthophoto or all the information that can be retrieved using typically map server. That so we use the we configure the server side in order to provide this kind of information, and on the client side to render on top of the terrain model this feature. But there is another level of abstraction, the 3D, in which we have two not two but three different level One is the terrain, that we can arrive to more resolute terrain, and we will so. And in the level of the single tree, that are single vectorial geometry that we render on top of the terrain, and the cable crane positioning system that is in forest, in mountain area, the typical way to extract the timber is to use a sort of cable crane that collect the cutted tree and bring it to the top or to the landing area in order to facilitate this kind of operation. But we can see better later. So the main source of data, we collect some geographical data like satellite, UAV, and terrestrial laser scanner data that we combine in pre-processing on batch work. And from the raw data, we obtain a sort of model of the forest in which in each single tree is modeled. You can see two different colors. The blue one are the trees that are modeled directly using terrestrial laser scanner, and we have more information about the geometry of the stem. Or each 10 centimeter, we measure the diameter of the stem, and we derive the geometry of this tree. But it's, of course, for reason of cost, we can survey all the forest with this kind of technologies, and we derive the other information, just the height and the diameter on the basis, with using some model developed by Forrester. So some feature of the client, we have so the first the 2D layer abstraction layer is several kind of information served like WMS service, web mapping service, and overimposed to the terrain. In this case, we can see road, some information about the parcels and the near infrared orthophotos of the area of interest. And we can switch and change, turn off the different layer in order to visualize it. There is the high resolution digital surface model of the forest. And in this case, we operate at the level of the Chisium terrain model, because Chisium allows the possibility to assess to a standard terrain model. But if you want to increase the resolution and the accuracy of the terrain with some of Haun proprietary model, we have developed a tool to create a multi-resolution terrain and provide it to the Chisium the client. Then there is the single tree visualization system, that is the visualization of each single tree that are pickable, and querying the database, you can retrieve on the tab the single information of the tree. Some feature to make a measure area or line drawing directly on the terrain. And the most important feature is the possibility to plan the, as you say before, as I said before, the cable crane, that is this kind of machinery that can catch the cutted stem and bring the the logs on a processing area when the entire log will be cut in single pieces. So there are some specifications to put this to install this this feature, and one of the requirement are that so due to the fact that positioning this system on the terrain is a quite time-consuming operation for the forest operator. If they have a sort of system that allow to plan how to put the different pylons of pillars of the cable crane, could be very useful. So, and we develop inside Cesium this this tool that the user can select the points and the pillar will be positioned, and providing also the height of the pillar, and there is a mathematical a physical equation that describes how the line will be the shape of the line between two pillars, and so you can derive the profile below the terrain below the line. And also another constraint is that in a pillar point, the angle between the line that arrive and start doesn't overcome a certain angle, because if it is too flat, it is not possible for the logs to move, and the line that you can saw below is the area in which the operational area in which it is possible to reach the cutted tree using this configuration. This another visualization of the simulated tool with the also the line of the catenary. Okay, this is the conclusion and future works. We have developed this tool for planning and the marking and the harvesting operation on mountain forest, that is totally web-based and service-oriented architecture system. Now we have to improve the service in order to make more query on the Forest Information System DB, and some tool that automatically generates the report on the planned activities, like which tree will be selected, and also because it could be useful for the operator that work directly on the field. I don't know if there is some now time for a short video. So this is the, you can select different area in which you have the survey, and where you have the more resolute terrain, and then you can turn on or turn off different layer, like the more accurate orthophotos or near infrared orthophotos, in order to identify some specific area on the zone. Then you can draw the line, line, and you can calculate the slope of the terrain. and this sort of external service like the weather in order to plan when you go to the field. And this is the multi-resolution terrain. So in this area we have the UAV survey, and we have a very resolute terrain, not outside, and we merge, and according to the level of detail we can load the different terrain. And then this is the 3D forest system with each symbol tree modeled. And so if you click on the tree, you can retrieve all the information that are contained on the database. And then probably at the end there is the simulator of the cable train positioning. You put the different position of the pillars with the specific height, and the system retrieves the operational area. And if this the maximum height, the minimum height from the terrain, and also if you have if you put in a wrong way the pillars, that this angle and this constraint are not maintained. If you put the red one is when it is not a good solution for putting.
Shall we give Federico a question, or?
Yes.
Thanks. One question to the multi-resolution terrain you used. Cesium supports the quantized mesh and the other tile format concerning the terrain. What kind of terrain do you use in your system?
We use the, we have two different possibilities. We have a terrain that follow the typical terrain model of Cesium, like is a regular grid terrain sampled on our on the input data, and we merge in a pre-processing phase all the different terrain, and so in if you know how the Cesium terrain works, it works at a level of details. When you go more close to the surface, the more resolute terrain will be loaded, and we create a unique terrain with different level of details accordingly to the different level. And we have, but is not yet implemented in this client, but in another one that you use in our research center. We use also a triangulated irregular network terrain that more or less is the same approach with different level of details, but not using a regular grid that have the same resolution also if there are a flat area or a mountain area, but we use this triangular irregular network in order to reduce the number of the points that we can on which we can model the terrain.
Thank you. Great, thanks. I know there's a follow-up question maybe after for later this evening. But let's thank the speakers for our session today.
Okay, so welcome to the Poster Fast Forward session. So this time the idea is that each poster presenter has about 2 to 3 minutes to convey the main ideas of the poster, to motivate to you to come to the poster to discuss later on with them. We have a poster program of 9 contributions, and the posters are already set up outside in the hall outside. So if you haven't done so, please come to the office, talk to the poster presenters, and now here is a fast preview of all the works. Authors will present in line, as displayed here. And yes, I would just ask presenters to stick to 2 to 3 minutes to keep in time. I will also take the time and signal once time is running out. So we will jump right into the first presentation of Xiaoming Zhu.
Thank you. As I try to load my model before I begin, because the model maybe take more than 2 minutes to load in, but anyway, I try first with my slides. You know, Graz has begun to produce the 3D model several years ago. Now we have the procedure like this to with the old photogrammetric measurement with DTM, with DSM, and a lot of these data sets together with our procedure to produce this 3D model automatically. Like this, we have DTM, we have TEAM, we have all the measurement from over 20 years to get this for other planning purpose, and now with our procedure to get automatically the roofs of the buildings, and it's we have just proved it. It's almost 100% right, correct. You see this, we can do the auto photos overlay on the DTM, and we can also produce the trees and in the models. Instead of that, a lot of other traffic symbols are also in 3D produced on these models. So Graz is not too small. It's over 60,000 buildings in the city. We have also finished 80% of the 60,000 buildings, and as I told, we have this automatic procedure. It can be done with the different data. Here we have photogrammetry measurement, so we can produce the LOD1. We can also use the cadastral data with the roof of the photogrammetry dome, digital surface model called in English here. We can combine it to get this model. Use cadastral data, you have also the address information behind this database, and you can call it. And there are several applications also done on these 3D models. Here we have flood simulation. You see here the buildings touch with the, yes, okay. I finished, I go to this this page. Everybody can call this page, like this address, 3D Graz AD. And with these different colors, so you can code from different project and the group in the different project, and now you have the 3D model like this with different layers. You can see it with the shadow and something like that. I see the time is over. Thank you.
Hello, I wanted to present my custom game engine. It's basically it's a game engine that is very closely related to X3D. I'm using X3D at a couple of places here. Okay, and first of all, I'm not hiding this fact that I'm very wanted to kind of make this poster, like tutorial today, also to kind of encourage people to contribute to the engine. It's really easy to get involved. It's also very easy to get actually to use it. I hope I was able to show it in the tutorial. So to develop your own games, actually to develop any applications using X3D. And for standalone or for mobile, Android, iOS, it all works there. Cool. Okay, engine is open source, so it's obvious you can take it and you can modify it any way you want. We're kind of trying to compete with larger commercial open source game engines. I think we are kind of close to succeeding, actually, so not that bad. We use XVD for everything. I mentioned actually two uses primarily. It's for serialization, so in normal worlds we can load model from XVD from VRML. And actually you can also save it back to VRML and XVD. And actually, but that's not all, we also can load model from any other formats. For example, you can use Spine, which is the right bottom slide. You can import models from some other formats like Collada. The main point here is that whatever you import, you know, whatever you load in our engine, it's still an XVD graph. So whatever you can use, basically the idea is that you can use many authoring tools to export to any format you feel comfortable with. You can load it in our engine. And it should work, yeah? And so it should work. You can load any object, and it should work, and it should also give you an XVD scene graph within our engine. So you can load XVD, even if you load Collada, if you load Spine, you still get XVD scene graph, and you're kind of at home. So, I mean, people in this room are at home, right? Because you know already the scene graph, you know the events, you know the fields, you can change everything, it's very efficient. And okay, so that's basically the idea about using the XVD for everything in the engine. I kind of wanted the engine to be, it was actually my main motivation back then, to make it modern. I mean, I didn't see many engines using a really open standards and having a modern graphic effect. So I kind of wanted, my main point of the one of my points of the engine was to make it really beautiful and really being able to create some interesting graphic effects. So you can turn on shading, go around the font, you can make any other custom, you can make custom shading. You can do things like compositing shaders, so you can kind of combine a couple of programs with that in OpenGL shading language into one effect. I hope to actually showcase it tomorrow. You have bump mapping, you have mirrors using cube maps, auto-generated cube maps, or planar textures. You have shadow maps, you have shadow balloons. You have screen effects, you can do with them screen set ambient occlusion, or any other actually kind of effect that you can imagine in a screen space. So that's kind of programmable and versatile. You have an API, you have a low-level API that basically says, okay, there's a three-dimensional model or two-dimensional model, load it, use it, transform it with my code. Or you have a higher-level view where you can say, okay, this model is at a level, and it has a placeholders which you can use to place initial, to spawn initial creatures on your level, or to place initial items on your level, or maybe this model is a creature, so it has an artificial intelligence, an AI. So it knows its enemy, it goes toward its enemy, or if it's scared, it runs from its enemy. So basically all these behaviors are kind of built in, and they're also extensible, right? So you can start from them, or you can start from scratch, from a bare creature, and extend them, modify them however you want. So it's kind of a lower level, you don't have a higher level approach, right? It's not just a 3D object, it's a 3D object with a predefined and configurable behavior. I hope this is actually very comfortable to use, not only for programmers, but also for level and game designers. Okay, some words about technology. We use a modern object Pascal language. I'm kind of emphasizing everywhere it's modern. It's not the language that you learn in school, called Pascal. It's a very modern version of it. It has classes, generics, units, everything you know from C++, Java, and other normal modern languages. So it's a very good language. It's also, okay. It's also very optimized, so it gives you a fast code, and our engine is very portable. So it works on any desktop operating system, Windows, Linux, Mac OS X, BSD, and anything you can find running OpenGL. And also mobile, Android, iOS. We also have plans, it's very much within reach to implement the Mozilla Star plugin, Tiki plugin, and other platforms like GL are kind of depending on the compiler support, so they are planned, but they are in the future.
Yeah,
that's it actually.
So hello, I present you my poster, which is about a 3D collaborative editor using WebGL and WebRTC. Got very good introduction with us and Ashes this morning. And this collaborative editor was mainly done in the context of how in a small group for design review, how can we collaborate directly without intermediary? Because if we are like five people, we don't have to speak to each other by another person. Like in client server, as a mimic of client server. So we wanted direct communication for 3D interaction in real time with without intermediary. So our application relies on an hybrid model for communication divided in two layers, one for persistence with the centralized data access and another for collaboration in peer-to-peer with different clients that are related through WebRTC connections. The protocol is data channel, and it relies on UDP, that's where the direct communication came from. And here you can have an overview, it's a screenshot of the interface. So there is the viewport in the editor with the 3D model. You can drag and drop the models, and they will be sent through the network to the other users. You can do some transformations, like translate, rotate, scale, scaling, and you can also change your point of view to from yours to another collaborator's point of view. So each update generates a message that is broadcast to the through the network. So we made some evaluation with qualitative criteria, like is the interface user friendly? Is there some latency or stuff like that? But now we want to have an evaluation with quantitative metrics like throughput or FPS. We also want to improve the interface plasticity to have a balance between the resources or the type of connection, type of device, which is the user interest or something like that. And we also want to optimize rendering using more the client as server in the peer-to-peer mesh to allow distributed resources and distributed computing. So that works. Thank you.
Hello, my name is Daniel. We are a group from Brazil. We are working on crowd simulation. We are building a crowd simulation framework. For now, we just have the handery layer, the visualization part. We are still working with the simulator part. And here is an actual screenshot of simulation running. The motives here in the cloud is extremely difficult in a browser. The JavaScript is a little slow for the job, but we can share things with the GPU and we can bust. This is an actual simulation running with collisions. The simulation took 2 days to run in a web browser, but the visualization is real time, 60 frames per second on the pre-computer simulation. And that is a live demo. You can access the URL, it's in the poster down there. And it doesn't have a collision simulation, so it's just handle walkers, and you can control the ground size and you can play with it. The colors are the agent speed, and this is another screenshot. It's very nice if you can access on your cell phones. The GPU can tell you how much agents you can render. That's good. Thank you.
Hi, everybody. I'm Stuart Anderson from CSIRO in Australia. And I've got two posters to talk about. I think they're both one after the other, which is convenient. The first one is Exploring the Genolan Caves. And it's about bringing the physical world to education of young students. So the Genolan Caves is a... I didn't realize that was animated.
This is a cave system in New South Wales, Australia. It's quite extensive, and obviously it's a bit of a tourist destination, but there's also a lot of education that can happen in a place like that, a lot of geology and other types of science. It's not always that feasible for students to travel there, and even if they do, they can't just run around loose, obviously, either. So what some of my colleagues have done is they've used a laser scanner developed at CSIRO called Zebedee to capture some point cloud data, which comes out a little bit noisy, but through our partners with InterScience, we've been cleaning that up and developing a game engine that we run through a web portal. So, develop
that. Give them 8.2 seconds.
Develop a game engine that we access through a web portal, and that houses a bunch of virtual activities. So the students can jump in there, run around, look for clues, and kind of get a bit hands-on. And it adds a lot of context to the information that they're trying to learn when they're in that environment. And there's just another screenshot there. So there's a map, and there's some objectives, and it's a very hands-on learning experience. And what we're trying to do, basically, is inspire the next generation of scientists by delivering science lessons that are fun. And that's all I've got for that one. I'll move on to my next one. Towards web-based semantic enrichment of 3D insects. Now, I think some of you have probably encountered the 3D insect thing before. I think some of my colleagues have talked a little bit about it here. But basically what we're doing is we have this scanning system we've developed called Insect Scan 3D. It's built out of off-the-shelf components. But it's pretty unique in that it's really good at capturing down to quite small sizes. So insects a centimetre and less, down to half a centimetre or even smaller potentially. So it's a two-axis turntable. It's a camera mounted on a macro lens so that we can capture large depth of field for the small objects. And we're using that to generate 3D models. But what this poster is really about is what's going to happen next. Capturing the specimen is really only the first step. What we want to do is put that specimen into the hands of the entomologists so that they can do useful things with it. And there's all this extra metadata. When you name a species or when you do something entomological like that, it's not just about the visual representation of the thing. There's all these extra biological characters. There's measurements. There's ratios of things to other things, there's colours, and there's all this extra stuff that defines what that specimen is. So all we want to do is develop web-based tools for annotation and viewing. Now, if the term annotation gets used a little bit, I've heard it a few times today, but a lot of the time that's limited people thinking about just taking a point and attaching some stuff to it. What I'd like to encourage everyone to do is think about annotation in quite a broad sense. Not just attaching things to points, but attaching things to areas, attaching things to pieces of surface area, to line segments, and all that sort of thing. And for us to be able to extract rich information from these digital libraries of insects. And of course, that will involve some support infrastructure as well. So we're working a little bit on this now. I'm not talking too much about this yet, but we've got a prototype system. Runs in a web browser and allows you to not only view all these different types of annotations, but also author them. So it's important that an entomologist who's not a computer science and doesn't know anything about 3D stuff, we want them to be able to jump in there, open up their tools and say, okay, select this area, this is an arm, select this area, this is a leg, take this measurement, compare it to this measurement, highlight this area, attach images and do all this sort of thing. So we're in the early stages of a prototype where a user can jump in, attach all this extra information to a 3D model, and other users can come in and view that information as well. And I'll be talking a little bit more about this stuff tomorrow at the Cultural and Natural Heritage if you're interested in hearing a bit more. But that's all, thanks.
Hello, my name is Manuel Karakakis. I'm with the University of Brunel. I'm a PhD student, and my main topic is on smart TV and the usability of internet on smart TV systems.
So if any of you has ever used a smart TV and tried to get to the internet, you must have noticed how nice the experience is, right? So yeah, the experience is really bad right now, and we're trying to search new ways to make it better. So one aspect of web on smart TVs and of web in general is Web3D. I thought that the smart TV is an interesting platform for Web3D and 3D stuff in general, mainly for two reasons. It's a large screen, so a large screen is nice to have 3D on it. And the most important is the 3D glasses. So while in PCs, 3D glasses are quite rare, it's not the same on computers. So 3D glasses are pretty standard there. So why not have a real-time 3D content on the web and see it on a large screen with 3D glasses? The sales of smart TVs has also been increasing lately, and you know, if you go to a store and get a TV, you'll probably end up with a smart TV even if you don't want to, because there aren't any more models. So the first aspect of it, I wanted to check to see how Web3D is working on the devices right now. So we did run a lot of tests on many devices. So it was hard to find many devices. I ended up ringing all my friends and saying, "Do you have smart TV? I'm going to test." And anyway, in this paper, I'm only saying about new nine models, because I want to have the same data for every year. So I checked three models from Samsung, LG, and Sony, 2012, 2013, and 2014. So what were the results? The results were that in 2012, no smart TV were supporting Web3D, WebGL. In 2013, two out of three companies supported the WebGL, and in 2014, all models supported Web3D, so that was good news. Sadly, the idea on 3D glasses wasn't so good. They didn't work at all. When you open the browser, they completely disabled this feature, so it doesn't work. But in 2015, I just found a new model from LG that does support it, and also the frame rates have been increased. They were very low previously, but now they are about 60 frames per second. Last year they were 15, and 2013 there were like 2 or 3 frames per second. So it's much better now. So from if you really want to make an application that works on all systems, because it's very fragmented market, there's no standard players, you know, there's LG, Samsung, Sony, they all have a small part of the market, so you have to make it cross-platform. To make it cross-platform, you have to use some kind of JavaScript feature detector, in my opinion, to switch between real-time 3D content and real-time and non-3D 2D content or video content. There was no other way if you want to make it really cross to make a production application. So in the future we plan to explore more devices, especially the new ones, and we're making a prototype TV, smart TV app based on our previous work, but will include some 3D features that we didn't have before, and try to make it to test it in many models, find the problems, and make a real guidelines for cross-platform Web3D applications. Thank you.
Wan-Pin Chang. Ben is a PhD student at NPS. I asked for some help on this one. Is Mike, you all set to go?
Yep.
Okay, so the organizers are very organized. They told us 2 minutes. So Mike's going to help me hit that. So we're going to talk about MATLAB and Simulink and how we hooked it up. We discovered that an ancient browser is still in there and getting refreshed by Humasoft, and everything worked pretty well. I'm going to jump ahead. How many people here have used MATLAB before? Maybe a few. How many students of your students have used it? Maybe all. It's quite pervasive. It is commercial, but it's very powerful. It has a lot of different toolkits. So we wanted to, and then we connected MATLAB for creation of figures, but also animation of X3D. And we tested a variety of paths through Simulink, the animation engine, to Vermal, to X3D, to X3DO. And the application we tested was radar. Pretty hairy equations for some folks, but we picked a fairly simple radar, not a parametric one, like we said. Electrical engineers could easily fill up all of these tables with different plot. And then we took that example from class and we launched it into these different browsers, and you can manipulate it. We have these examples are all getting posted online and in different forms and make sure that it works. Okay, so here's the flow again, and notice it's not one flow, but you can go in multiple different directions. So we think that Simulink, as well as MATLAB itself, is still perfectly suitable, and we've come up with a wish list for the MathWorks company of all. And so you'll see in our demo, we took their bouncing ball and turned it into a bouncing cube. It's just a simple kinematic, actually dynamic, second order physics, but going down, the force is proportional to the compression and it bounces up again. And I think we're just about done. This is the video that's up there. We can show it either with attenuation of absorption factor or bounces forever, keeps going and going and okay. 2 minutes, thank you.
Yeah, thanks very much to all presenters, especially for being so precisely on time. Thanks very much again to all poster presenters, and please be sure to talk to poster authors during the conference. Thank you.